podcast is intended for mature audiences. The views and opinions expressed are those of the panelists and do not reflect in any way those of the podcast partners, sponsors, or affiliates. Enjoy.
Hi, this is Michael Buffer, and you're listening to the voice of the people. Let's get ready for Boxing Voice.
I think all of a sudden, you know, does the Joshua Fury fight start taking priority maybe over a Pulev fight if the Pulev fight extends beyond the summer? I mean, there's so much that could happen right now. You know, one thing's for sure.
Could that be overridden with the contract?
Possibly. I mean, anything's possible, but contractually, Deontay Wilder's going to...
Hey, Daddy, this a dollar beat.
BoxingVoice.com.
No matter what nobody say, man, spirit, can't nobody fuck with me, man. You know, I can't be fucked with, you know.
Dollar D Beyonce Productions.
Whether you pay to see me win or you pay to see me lose, you're gonna pay. Fuck it, your kids still gotta eat. I don't have to watch, you know, any footage of a fighter. I mean, because I'm Floyd Mayweather, everybody gotta watch me. I knew eventually I was gonna have to fight Oscar. I feel like he was straight up and down, no really no special effects.
BoxingVoice.com.
How can Canelo have the biggest deal? Your deal is for $300 million. And I made $350 million just in one fight. And you're fighting on the app.
BoxingVoice.com.
I'm a king, okay? I eat a feast. Every time I eat a feast. And when I get up from the table, I don't give a fuck who get the leftovers. At the end of the day, follow my green friend.
Dollar D Beyonce Productions.
BoxingVoice.com.
Ain't no other sight in the game to see the Boxing Voice.
Good morning, TBV. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to another glorious Friday morning. Thank God it's Friday for all my blue-collar workers out there. Shout out to you guys. You're getting the weekend off. And just a really big thank you and a round of applause to everyone that continues to support the movement. I mean, yesterday we reported we went from 283 to 299. Then we did the morning show. We went from 299 to 302. Then we did the evening show and we jumped up to like 308. We wake up this morning, we're at 314. If you don't know what these numbers are and what they mean, we're talking about actual living, breathing, supporting Patreons that truly believe in the movement. So just want to salute everyone that continues to rock out with TBV, ensuring that Mike and Mario stick around here on a full-time capacity. This morning, we're going to be talking about Anthony Joshua, Tyson Fury, and the fact that this could take place or take priority over Pulev, who is the mandatory. Plus, we'll couple that with Demetrius Andrade and Liam Williams looking like it's heading to purse bid. Frank Warren wants that in the UK. Then we'll add in three fantastic interviews with Lennox Allen in the super middleweight division. We'll also have Edgar Belanga in the middleweight division, 13-0 with 13 KOs. And then we'll also have upset specialist in the heavyweight division, Roberto Hellenius. So, yeah, man, we got a lot planned for you guys, and I hope you are ready for this. You know the number to call in if you want to call in absolutely free from anywhere in the world, plus 1-425-569-5241. And if you are a Patreon on, you know, that every daily show level, well, then you can add Nestor Gibbs on Skype and be part of this conversation this fine morning. Don't forget, if you're a patron of the lowest level, as little as three, or three and up, rather, should I say, you can ask Edgar Belanga a question, and you can ask Lennon Allen a question, and you can ask Robert Hellenius a question. But let me head on out to my co-host in Corpus Christi, get this thing started. Buenos dias.
It's me, Mario.
What up, what up, what up? Little late start for me, but, you know, I'm trucking through. Yeah, man, interview after interview after interview. I don't think anybody else is doing that. but definitely excited to talk to the guests today. You know, chop up this topic because it's a really complicated topic. It's very dicey when you come at it from different angles. You know, as a boxing fan, of course, you just want to see the best fights. You know, but as a promoter, well, as a promoter, you want to put on the best fights, but as a fighter and just as like a decent human being, like you don't want to see somebody who's about to shoot their shot not even get time on the court, you know, not even get to clock in. So I don't know. It's definitely a mixed bag for me. But yeah, we'll chop it up.
Yeah, man. I mean, look, we just went over the official press release from MTK Global, Queensberry Promotion, who is Frank Warren, and Top Rank, who is obviously Bob Arum. All three have a say in Tyson Fury's career. MTK Global, the management company, and the two promoters are Frank Warren and Bob Arum. They made it clear about 48 hours ago that any news concerning Tyson Fury should be taken with a grain of salt if it's not coming from those three specific channels. And, you know, I pieced it together for you guys that show that this was a direct shot at this guy, Eddie Hearn, because here he is again saying how Tyson Fury versus Anthony Joshua takes priority over his mandatory and how he thinks it could get done. It's like, bro, they just said that you're stunting and that we should not believe you. I don't understand why I believe him now. I think this is classic, classic AJ and Eddie. I think that, you know, they were very good at manipulating the media into believing that Deontay Wilder was the one clout chasing their name. You know, Eddie had it out every time that, you know, AJ had something, Wilder would have come and announce. But it seems the other way. It seems like they desperately want to attach their names to this Tyson Fury Wilder trilogy. Instead of just continuing to work on promoting Pulev, I mean, there's zero promotion for Pulev. There's only been an announcement. There was never a press conference. Now we got the coronavirus possibly pushing it back an entire month to July or the end of July. I mean, why is he still talking about a guy that he lost his opportunity to promote? His offers to Tyson, while I continue to be on the record that they were very handsome, they were not enough for Tyson.
Well, the fight itself at this point has a new meaning, I think. Before it was like, you know, taking fights as we can get them between the three, Wilder, Fury, and Joshua. Now it's like we have some sort of supremacy, I guess. You know, some people might say that Joshua is not the real deal because he lost to Ruiz, although he came back and won the rematch. Some people might not say that Tyson Fury is the real deal because Wilder should have beat him in the first one with that knockout. But Fury went on to win that second fight. And I thought he won the first fight too. So, you know, and some people might say Wilder doesn't deserve it because he lost to Fury in some people's eyes twice. The bottom line here is we just want these guys to fight. At the same time, like, we don't want to be lied to. Look, I believed Eddie when he said that Joshua Fury was very close, or that they had all the big things worked out and they were basically coming down to network. I believed him. I gave him the benefit of the doubt. This just sounds crazy. Like, how are you going to tell Fury and his promotion what they're going to do? Like, how are you going to sit here and say, well, you know, this is takes priority because of this? Like, it's your fighter. And I'm going to be honest, Joshua is the one that needs Fury. I mean, at this point, you know, with the loss, I'm not trying to say that Joshua isn't a great fighter, because I do believe he is a great fighter. I think he's definitely beatable, but I thought he was beatable before Ruiz, so that doesn't really change my mind or alter my opinion in any way. What it does is it kind of just seems desperate. Now it just kind of it's starting to reek a little bit, you know? It's one thing to have COVID-19, the coronavirus, you know, shut down everything and you trying to keep your fighters' names in the mix. And it's another thing when you're like that stalker who just keeps sending these random texts to people. Like, it's just, I don't know. Look, I don't know how much communication they've had. I don't know how legit any of these claims that Eddie's made are. But at this point, the other side is saying that they're not legit. And, you know, they've been saying that. And at first I thought, well, they're trying to hide the fact that they were about to, you know, make a deal. And now with him trying to push fights out for Joshua, Fury, like Wilder, I mean, he's trying to control the narrative. Like, and here's the other thing, like, you're not going to get past Wilder Fury. Like, I don't know what he thinks he's going to be able to do in that situation, or what he thinks any of them are going to be able to do in that situation. You know, if he's going to cover the legal bills that are going to come from, you know, breaking a contract, well, whatever, then, you know, then that's his business. But he's not going to do that. And we know he's not going to do that. So it's just stupid to get ahead of anything. You want to get ahead of Pulev, but we're not even ahead of Fury Wilder. Like, that doesn't make any sense. You know, Wilder deserves his rematch. He does, because it was in the contract.
And obviously this coronavirus is playing into Wilder's favor. He'll get more time. Not that he wanted it, but a lot of Wilder fans, a lot of, you know, quote unquote, Monday morning boxing coaches felt like he needed more time. So here's that added time, because like we said yesterday, there's just no way you could promote Wilder Fury coming off this coronavirus. We gotta survey the landscape, see how you know, people are doing with their economics. You know, how has this affected the country, if not the world? Before, I just think there's gonna be a lot of stuff on halt. But hearing the promoters, they seem dead set and ready to kind of get business going again. So while, you know, it may start off with like no fan attended venues, I think we will start to see, you know, television only production when it comes to boxing events.
Yeah, and here's the thing, you know, with fights like Joshua, Wilder, Fury, that magnitude, I don't think those can be done like that. I mean, I don't think they will be done. I mean, of course they could be done like that, but I don't think they will be done like that. I think that we're going to have to wait until we get past all of this before the Canelos of the world, the Joshuas of the world, the Wilders, the Furies, the Mayweathers, the you know, all these guys who are big time fighters, who it costs a lot of money to put on their fight, or, you know, to put on the production for them to fight. You know, they count on that gate money. You know what I'm saying? And so it's going to be really hard for them to get something like that done. And I don't think we do. So it just pushes back everything further and further.
I mean, just wonder if the partners, though, I wonder if the partners, you know, let's say DAZN and Sky bump up a little more money, because they need content. Because guess what? While boxing needs fight fans, Mario, right now is the time for television to take over while people are stuck at home. People are stuck at home. Some are forced to be home. Some have the privilege that their bosses allow them to work from home. But home is where the heart is while this is happening. And you need television. Like, you need television right now. You need to stay entertained. And if you're a broadcaster, you're trying to bait those people in. You don't want them picking up books or playing chess or anything else other than turning on that tube, you getting those ratings, and you cashing in them advertiser checks.
Yeah, it's kind of a weird thing too, right? Like, what kind of advertiser? I mean, like, I don't know. That's weird. Like,
what do you mean?
Advertising.
Food.
Well, it's food. Just like, I mean, what kind of advertisers?
Food, like, advertisers, dude. Everybody wants you to eat, and everyone is still delivering. Everyone is still delivering. They got curfews over
right.
here,
and
but
it's not like beer is gonna go away. So,
bruh.
I mean, there have been reports that they're gonna stop shipments, and at some point, or there have been reports that, like, you know, alcohol sales could take a huge hit.
I doubt
because
it
because of distribution.
I
mean,
doubt
yeah,
it because the distribution,
that's
the distribution,
in the Wall Street Journal.
Oh well, that's different. I can't go against that. But I'm just I'm gonna go on my hunch that I doubt it, because guys like Joseph, JD. All the truck drivers still working, and as long as they're working, you know, they're shipping goods up and down the interstate highways. So, you know, things are getting where they need to get.
If we get to a point where they start to open it up, and it's like, okay, we'll allow like 100, 500 people, whatever. I don't know what that number is. I'm not going to speculate. But I think at that point, you know, definitely. But I don't know if I even want to see Joshua Fury or Pacquiao, Mayweather, or whatever big fights without an audience. It adds to the ambiance. Like, it's just these. Listen, the showbox was cool.
I believe they would still find audiences for that, because look, Tom Hanks and his wife got tested. These famous people can get tested. Those are the same people we see on our television screen. So they'll just get a list of approved people, maybe. You know, it's all about listening to Eddie's interview. He's just looking how to work it around. He's like, well, if they say 20, you know, then we figure out if 20 includes the camera crews and da da da. Like, he's looking for his angles, man.
Yeah, for sure. You're right. You know, it's just the thing that scary or not even scary. Well, it's definitely scary. But the thing that's makes all of this hard to assess is that every day it changes. The goalpost gets pushed back further and further. You know what I mean? It was like we were going to have 2 weeks without baseball. And that's a joke. Like that was the first, you know, that was a joke. So, you know, and they're talking about pushing back. Or we talked about on the show yesterday. If you haven't checked out the Thursday show, Thursday evening show, go and do that on Playback,
which is $5. So if you're a $5 patron and you've been for a long time, you can definitely check out the Playback and the audio only version of Thursday show. And it's available on Patreon right now, and you get it with no ads. I mean, yo, I feel so happy to be able to deliver that because I'm getting, you know, messages from people who want the audio only and are ecstatic that there's no ads. Because, listen, there's ads. You know, Spreaker throws ads in there. You know, they ain't going to just have 4 hours of content and not try to make no money. That's just how the world works. So, you know, being a Patreon, you don't have to get any of those bullshit interruptions. Speaking of my interruption, you know, 9:30, we should be having Robert Hellenius, the first guest. 10 o'clock will be Lennox Allen. And if we stay on long enough, if the boxing talk goes long enough, we got enough callers and we stay till 11, we'll keep our scheduled Edgar Balanga interview at 11. My man does not wake up early. But, yeah, man. Shout out to all the patrons, man. 314.
Yeah, thank you, because I forgot what tier it was. That's why I was – so it was, that was a dynamite drop-in. But, yeah, it just every single day that we get news, it's just, like, more and more disappointing. If it's like you relegate it to thinking about the way that boxing works, then it is more depressing. I mean, it's depressing in life in general, the way things are going right now. But, I mean, boxing, because it takes so much to promote a fight. Like, you don't need to promote the Washington Nationals versus the Milwaukee Brewers. You don't need to promote the Houston Rockets versus the LA Lakers. Like, those guys are going to play, and teams and people are going to show up. You know what I mean? That's just the nature of their businesses. But with boxing, people have to understand that, you know, if you have this gate, right? Like, they don't just open. They have an idea of how many people are going to come and buy tickets, right? And they have an idea of how many people they're going to give tickets away, you know, comp tickets to. But then the promotion kicks into gear, and they figure, okay, if we promote this much, if we spend this much on ad revenue, then we're going to get this much of return on ticket sales, you know? And to not be able to really go through that whole process, it's hard. Look, when I remember when De La Hoya Mayweather got made, it was like damn near November or December. It was somewhere around December, like between November and January, and I felt so far away. And guess what happened? It was the biggest fight that I'd ever seen take place. And I had so many people who I didn't even know watch boxing. They were like, yo, you're going to watch Mayweather De La Hoya. So, you know what I mean? Like, that time is very precious. And, you know, sometimes it can overcook a fight. Sometimes you can hear about a fight over and over and be like, okay, we get it. But that's very, very rare. You know what I mean? When the fight is good, when the fighters are good, when you got a good A side, a good B side, it's you know, it seems like it markets itself, but it doesn't. There are so many people behind the scenes that are working and making things happen, you know, to promote these fights. So they need time. They need time to not necessarily marinate. That's a different thing. You know, marinate is them not coming together, you know, them trying to build fights for future down the road, and they're having promotions in between, letting it marinate, right? Something like a Shakur Stevenson and or like a Ryan Garcia Tank. You know, that's got to marinate a little bit more, in my opinion, and it will marinate a little more. Hopefully not longer than we want, but that could be the case. In this case, it's about, you know, taking time out to get the promotions done and taking time out to make sure that everything's done right. And we are in a very, very delicate stage in boxing where the heavyweight division is on the rise. It, you know, it's here, it's back, but it's still rising. It's still getting bigger. So as a boxing fan who missed that great generation of the 80s and the 70s when boxing was one of the most talked about sports in the world, you know, I missed that generation. I wasn't there. You know, I caught it like the tail end. And so I want to go back to those days where boxing was the first thing reported on, you know, on the news and Sports Center and stuff like that. I just want to go back to those days, and this heavyweight boxing could bring us back, but it's like with all this going on, it just dampers everything. And does it stunt the growth of boxing, specifically heavyweight boxing? You know, it's too soon to tell.
Yeah, I mean, the honest truth is we got to stop relying on boxing and boxing sources for our news when it comes to what's happening next, because they have to follow suit with any other entity. So, you know, right now people are saying, oh, well, you know, we're pushing it back to July. Like, and who's to say that July we're going to be in any better shape? We should be thinking about vaccine, you know, because, again, how could you reschedule if we don't have any certainty on the virus itself? So pushing it back a month is only hoping that there is some sort of containment and or vaccine for the virus. So I think that even when Eddie says, oh, we're going to push, you know, AJ and Pulev back, that's just cheek and chung. Like, he doesn't even know. We don't know what's going to happen. But let me play the audio, and then let's get into that second topic before we open up these lines. Remember, in about 8 minutes, we should be having Robert Hellenius.
I think all of a sudden, you know, does the Joshua Fury fight start taking priority maybe over a Pulev fight if the Pulev fight extends beyond the summer? I mean, there's so much that could happen right now. You know,
I don't even know what that means. If the Pulev fight extends beyond the summer. So obviously beyond the summer means September. But why would the Pulev fight take that long? Is he meaning purely on, you know, the outcome of the virus? Or does he mean, or does he mean Pulev extending it?
No. He means that the virus, you know, and the uncertainty that we're facing, extending those dates.
Now, speaking of Joshua Pulev, Pulev came out on his social media and said that the fight is off and will be rescheduled. Obviously, Eddie and others have come out and said that that isn't official, that the fight is still on. But according to Pulev, it's going to be rescheduled. Let's see here. Back to the audio.
He's going to cost him.
Uh-oh. What'd I do there? How many things I got playing here?
Ridden with the with
possibly
contracts.
I mean, anything's possible, but contractually Deontay Wilder's gonna want his fight next. Now, whether that's in July or whether there's a force move.
Now let's just stop it there, because we read the press release a few days ago and they were specific. The second paragraph was saying how great Tyson is, all his accomplishments, but it ended in he is contracted to face Deontay Wilder in a third fight. If we remember that press release, they told us not to believe any outside channels that weren't Queensberry Promotions, MTK Global, or Top Rank. Just want to remind you of that.
That takes that to October, November, wherever.
So, well, they've come out and said that, haven't they?
Yeah. I mean, right now, for us, we're fighting Kubrat Pulev, June the 20th, and it could be July the 25th. But everything is uncertain at the moment, whilst...
And again, you see, July the 25th, so he's giving himself another month cushion, but he doesn't know what will be, you know, the status of the virus. Just don't know. And I know that they'll lose the opportunity to be in that stadium because of their, you know, soccer team is going to come back eventually.
Country and the world tries to contain this pandemic.
So there you go. That is the audio. Now, the second topic before we open up them lines, we got another 5 minutes before we get to Robert Hellenius, heavyweight upset specialist. Took out my guy, Adam Kornacki, man. Damn, he took him out. But yeah, Liam Williams. I keep calling him Smith. Jesus. Liam Williams and Demetrius Andrade. Scheduled for a WBO purse bid, but because of the coronavirus, they've postponed it. And because of that, Frank Warren is saying, we might need to bring this to the UK. Obviously, it doesn't mean much. But for Andrade, I think he needs to go to the UK, you know, possibly gain some fans and some social media followers, help his positioning at the negotiation table, really. If you fight Liam Williams in Providence, who knows him besides the hardcore fans? And I mean hardcore fans.
Yeah, man, that's probably the best way to put this in the way that I would have put it. I don't think very many people do, to be honest with you. If that was a question, I don't know if it was rhetorical or not, but I'll answer it anyway. I don't know. I really don't know. I mean, look, I don't. Here's the thing. The only benefit I see is whether or not it happening in the UK makes it happen faster. Like if they're assuming that there's some place they could get it done at some specific point in the year, regardless of how you know, the coronavirus is going. I mean, obviously, if it's spread to like contagion levels where, you know, we're at the zombie apocalypse type stuff, then yeah, that's not going to happen anywhere. But if there is something that they have to provide for this fight, as far as venue and getting around certain loopholes, then yeah, I'm all for it. But as far as the fight itself, just moving, you know, for moving sake, like if it could get done in the original spot, I think they were thinking. I don't remember now, but
Tottenham, you know, they could get, Stadium or something like that.
Yeah, something like that. You know, then to me it's whatever. But I just don't see it helping Andrade, like, for any reason. Andrade is the type of fighter who just, he needs to be in that big stage. That's where he's going to break through. That's where he's going to cross over. Williams is a great fight, and I really like that fight, but that's not the kind of fight I'm talking about. So regardless of whether or not he could pick up UK fans or Saudi Arabia fans, if it happened there, like wherever it happened, it just does not mean what it would mean if he was fighting a big time fight. You know what I mean? So that's really the most important. That's going to be his crossover appeal. So I'm all for the UK if they can find a way to make this fight happen.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I have our first guest, Robert Hellenius, in a heavyweight division. They're calling him the upset specialist. Robert, you took out my guy, man. Adam Kornacki was a big, big friend of this show. We thought highly of him, and you gave him his first knockout loss. How excited are you with your performance?
The performance was good. I was very confident already before the fight that I would win, because I've been boxing against guys like him many, many times since I was an amateur. I've been boxing for over 20 years now. So, of course, as well, I've been training really, really good before this fight, and I haven't been injured in a couple of years now, and I had really big issues. Like five years ago, I had hand operations and everything. So first time for 2 years, I've been training without injuries and sicknesses. So I feel good.
So Robert, man,
I feel like I'm coming back.
Well, you definitely came back already, man, and that's what I wanna ask you. How much has your phone been ringing with opportunities? Because I do not believe. I do not believe that you're tied to PBC, right? Like, you can actually walk away, or are you with Al Haymon and PBC now?
We are in a cooperation with PBC, yes. So we have a fight coming up with them next as well. So I'm looking forward to that as well. I'm happy that they gave me the opportunity to show my true skills.
Beautiful, beautiful. Because I could imagine how all these promoters must want to talk to you after winning an eliminator position in the WBA, knocking off a heavily touted up-and-coming contender on the brink of a title shot. So I just figured maybe Eddie's probably calling, maybe already Bob wants to get you on the roster. Yeah, man, I know how this heavyweight division is.
It's funny, but I know, but I have a buffer, you know, my manager, Marcus Sundman, he's taking all the calls, so, and he's not bothering me right now about them, because of this coronavirus outbreak, and I hope everybody's doing well there as well. So everything is a little bit on hold now, sadly.
So I gotta ask, man, how vital was that Nathan Gorman sparring? Did he really help you prepare for Adam? Are their styles that similar, or sparring is sparring?
Sparring is sparring, of course, but of course he's a good boxer, and he has similarities to Adam Kovnacki. He's a bulldozer coming strong all the time, and we had like three other guys as well, same style, just coming and breaking me down in training. So I was prepared for this, you know.
Hey, Robert, this is Mario Munguia. First of all, congratulations on the fight. It was an incredibly action-packed fight. I enjoyed it so much. I am a huge fan of Adam. I've been covering him for years, but I've been watching you for years too. So I was happy that if anybody was going to beat him, you know, it's somebody who's going to pull one of these upsets. Let me ask you a question, though. As far as the momentum for beating a guy like Adam, how important is it for you to get back in the ring right away to keep that momentum, and how disappointing is it with this COVID-19? I mean, how do you keep the momentum with the uncertainty of this virus and not knowing when boxing will resume again?
Yeah, it's very sad. Of course, I'm already back at training. I was the first week, took a couple of days off just to get the time zones difference again. So I've been training for 1.5 weeks now, and I'm just waiting for the next opportunity, and I hope this will blow over soon so I can get back in action.
Now, you were a huge underdog from a betting standpoint. Have you had any people on social media or anything, or people stop you on the street and thank you because they won a bunch of money? I think you were a +900.
Yeah. I have had those.
No special thanks?
It's always funny. For special thanks, that I made them rich. Not rich, but they won fair amount of money. Yeah.
Now, again,
I like a good fight. I like a good challenge.
Well, speaking of a good challenge, the Adam Kovnacki fight was a great challenge. I had fun watching it. I'm sure I know everybody did. Would you consider a rematch with him right away or sometime down the road? I mean, when would you think that rematch would be possible?
I don't know. I hope he's okay. I have he's a good fighter. I have nothing against him, and of course, but. It's very uncertain, and I haven't had the time to think what is the next step. I hope this virus blows over really quick that we can get back to organizing fights and the preparing and doing all. I want to get back as soon as possible. I don't know the next fight, but of course I'm happy to take a rematch.
Got it. Wow, that's great. Awesome. One more question before I pass you back off to Ness. I wanted to ask you, our topic today was about Eddie Hearn coming out and talking about the Joshua Pulev fight and postponing it, not letting it happen because a fight with Fury is more important or more meaningful. From a boxer's standpoint, what do you think about that when you hear a promoter saying that mandatory should be waived because there's a more important fight. Like, you know, we see step aside money all the time. We see all this kind of stuff. What does that make you think? Because you're in a situation now where you've earned a spot among these top guys, and in a fight with one of them, if you continue to win, is on the horizon. So how do you feel about that?
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of politics in boxing. It has always been like that, but I don't know. You know, there's a lot of good fighters out there that want the chance to box for a heavyweight title. I feel like if you do good, you win fights, like eliminated fights, that you should get the fight. I think there's too much politics in heavyweight or in title fights. I think the best should fight the best.
Definitely, man. Who do you have your eyes? I mean, you were in an eliminator. Who would you expect to be facing? The winner of Manuel Char and Trevor Bryan, or straight at Joshua?
I'm ready for whoever comes my way. Like I said, I've been training injury free for 2 years now, and I feel like finally every injury and sickness has gone out my body, and I feel like I'm actually making like progression in my fighting and in my training and everything. So I'll be ready when the time comes to get anybody.
You know, when they asked you that question right after the fight, you know, you knew what was at stake. So like blocking all that out, the fact that this heavyweight division is so jam-packed and that there's so many fights, I mean, do you realistically think that you could get something with one of these names like Joshua, Fury, Wilder, these guys that are so congested with fights? Do you think you can get something with them soon, or do you think you're going to have to continue to fight the Kawanakis of the world, you know, the Charles Martins of the world, stuff like that?
Yeah, I hope I'll get the chance, but you know, it takes a lot for one fight to happen, a lot of politics, a lot of negotiating back and forth and stuff like that. So, you know, that's why I have my manager to fix that stuff. I'm happy to take anybody, you know. I just want to show that I'm back and I'm not gone. I'm old, but not dead.
That's a perfect way to put it. So you said that you've been fighting, you know, injury free for the first time in a long time. Were there any special rehabs that you went through? Is there any special type of things that, because I know like athletes now are using like cryogenics, they're using, you know, hot stone yoga, I've seen, you know, the needles, the suction cups. What were the types of things that you went through with rehab,
the cryo
your
box,
body where it's at
the cryo
today?
Box. Yeah, just hard training with my trainer, Johan Lindström. He's a fabulous trainer. He was a physio trainer when we started, and then he has been fighting also when he was younger, so he knew a little bit boxing and fighting in general. So I stuck with him because he made my body feel new again, and it has taken like four years before I got to this point that I feel that I'm doing progression, because I had a really big shoulder operation in 2011, and it took like 4 or 5 years before I could you know, be myself again without it hurting, punches and stuff like that. They made a big surgery. They from my thigh and in my shoulder, and it has taken a long time back, and now it has been like 3 training camps without pain in my shoulder, so I feel really, really good.
That's awesome. That's great to hear. Now, I was going to Pass it to me.
He was going to pass it to me so I can give you some questions from the people. We got George Foster in the UK who says, where do you rank yourself at the heavyweight after your big win?
I always am number one, of course. You know, so if they come back to fight, I thought I was number one. So.
You say you're number one. I like it. We got the Earthquake that says, the way you weathered the storm and found your openings was class. Congrats on the win. Who's next?
Thank you. Yeah, that's a big question. I don't know. That's a lot of politics behind that. So I hope to get the world title fight as soon as possible.
We got Steve in the UK says, hi, Robert. Massive congratulations on your victory and showcasing why the heavyweight boxing is must-watch TV. My question is, out of the three hottest prospects in the heavyweight division, F.A. Ajagba, Daniel Dubois, and Philip Hergovich, which one of the three ends up challenging you for the undisputed title? Thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks. Congrats. It doesn't matter who of them three comes at me, you know? Everybody.
Definitely. So you'll take them
all. But which one is the most promising to you, though, out of those three?
Or who would be the bigger draw out of those three?
Maybe Efe Ajagba.
Wow, you think he's a bigger draw than Dubois?
Yeah. I haven't so many tries with Dubois.
All right. We're slightly breaking up a bit. If you can maybe move around just slightly. The next question is from Rue in the 504 New Orleans. He says, what are the plans for the rest of the year?
Yeah, we had big plans, but we don't know when we're going to the ring. Possible.
You're breaking up, champ. We cannot hear you.
Oh, shit. Sorry. Hello?
Yes.
Do you hear me now?
Yeah, we hear you now.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so I hope I'll be in the ring as soon as possible. The plans were to get at least two fights this year still.
Great. That's great.
Daniel White says, which heavyweight has hit you the hardest?
I think it would be maybe Samuel Peters.
You said Samuel Peters?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Wow. Let me see here. We got Ryan, a.k.a. Dempsey, says, have you noticed any changes in regards to how the boxing media views you as a contender now that you have beaten Adam? So meaning anyone other than us who all of a sudden now wants to interview you.
Yeah, you know, I don't like to read. I have never liked to read about myself or even listen to my interviews or nothing. I just watch my fights. And I try to you know, be my own person and not let the media dictate how I feel about myself.
All right. So we got Sid in Florida says, congrats on your victory. How did you feel about all the Fury glove and Farmer controversy?
Thank you for the congrats. I haven't heard about the controversy though, because like I said, I don't read a lot of media.
Good.
I live in the forest. We have internet and everything, but you know, I have three kids as well, so my spare time goes to them, and I'm bad at following media and other boxers.
Understandable. We got Kristen Camillo says, if you can secure a fight with one of the big three, what top contenders interest you until you get that title shot? So if you can't get a shot at, obviously, Tyson, Wilder, or AJ, who under those three are on your radar? Top hit list. Top hit list.
That's a difficult question. Yeah, there is a lot of big names there, and a lot of good fighters, and it's hard because I've been thinking about that now. I'm gonna be ready for whoever comes. You know, I'm gonna be ready for whoever. It doesn't matter.
All right, we got Mr. Sims that says, man, I loved your game plan. That hook to the body was exceptional. You gained the fan after interview. You gained the fan after the interview beforehand and performance. My question: will you be waiting around for AJ Pulev winner or get to another fight? Well, that's a different angle there. Would you wait around for your title shot, or are you gonna just give you something?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, though. That's an interesting question. thanks for the congrats, brother. I want to stay active, so I probably will go for a fight here in between as well.
Great answer, you know what I mean? I did not want to hear you say that you were going to wait around, even though, listen, it some people do it. You know, you got Trevor Bryant still waiting, and Manuel Char still waiting. So, you know, those guys love to wait. Fresno Kendo's been waiting for all his life. But yeah,
I'm not like that. I'm not like that. I'm a Viking, you know. I live for fighting.
Definitely, definitely. All right, so we got a few more, and you're out of here. We got Israel Weber in Oklahoma says, congrats on your recent win. Thanks for coming on the Boxing Voice. No question here. Let me know when you make your inevitable trip to Oklahoma City, and we'll do lunch. So just a congratulations and an invite to lunch. There you go.
Thank you very much.
We got
Thank you very much. I will.
Rick in Atlanta, the ATL, he says, what one thing most contributed to your excellent win over Kovnacki? Yeah, one question per person. So what was it that you contribute to that win? What do you think did it? That one thing. He wants to know that one thing.
I think, one thing. Yeah, that I have to say it's the injury-free training for a couple of years now, and of course my diet is almost only meat and proteins.
Damn,
kind of
true Viking, only meat, huh?
I feel like only meat and the eggs and stuff like that. Dairy sometimes. Yeah.
And you would figure...
Almost carnivore.
Carnivore. Yeah, wow. How long have you been doing that
almost carnivore,
that diet?
Yeah. 2 years now. Yeah, 2 years. Wow. And I feel excellent. And I feel the body changes, you know. Less fat around the belly, and yeah, I feel stronger. I feel more energetic, and I feel like the fog from my brain's gone as well. So.
Wow!
Now, do you do that only during camp, or just for the last 2 years? Period.
No, it's my lifestyle. I've been doing it for 2 years. Like I said, I feel much better. Of course, I have some off days, like once a month, that I throw some like rice and potatoes and stuff like that. And sometimes my favorite snack before going carnivore was chips. So, but I like once for 2 months I eat some snacks, but that's all. Otherwise, I eat 2 times a day and a big meat portion.
All right, we got a few more here. Caesar in Las Vegas, congrats on the big win, champ, and thank you for coming on and answering the questions. Where are you currently located in, and how has the pandemic affected your community in terms of the coronavirus?
Thank you very much for the congrats. Yeah, we are in a shutdown. Our schools are shut down, and we can't travel anywhere. If you travel and come back, you have to be in quarantine in 14 days. And that's what happened when we came back from New York. So this is like my final day that I'm in quarantine in my home. I've only been traveling to my gym, and it's a private gym there, so there's nobody else. It's me and my trainer, and it has affected, like, I think a lot of people is angry and can't get to work. And but we have a small community, and we have a big resources, so I think we will manage this one out. So thanks for the question.
So we got a few more, but I want to ask. Yesterday we had Iceland heavyweight Colbin Christensen, and he said he did some sparring with you.
Yeah.
And that you guys are really good friends and spar a lot, man. You want to tell us anything about that?
Yeah, three, four years. I don't remember how long we've been knowing each other, but he is my size guy, and he's been over a lot to this island where I live for sparring and general training. He's a good guy. He's a really, really good guy.
He said he would never fight
you. He's also helped me a lot with technique. But
he said he would never fight you.
Excuse me. I don't want to fight him either, because I think we're two good friends.
Definitely. To do that. Definitely. All right. So we got New Orleans back with another one. JT says, do you think Canelo fights the toughest opponents out there?
Yeah, I have to go back to, I don't follow a lot of, but I have seen, when I was in Wilder camp last year, I saw Canelo fight. I don't know. I hope so. I can't say anything negative. I haven't been studying who's the best in that division.
Yo, Robert, what's up with this headgear you had on with the in the Wilder camp, bro? You had the whole chin strap protector.
No.
Yeah. May 3rd, 2019. I'm like, whoa, I see. Listen, look, what did you think of that fight? Did you knew it was going to be like that? I mean, you've seen Fury fight. You've been in the Wilder camp. How did you, what did you think the match was going
to
look like?
I've been to both camps. I didn't actually know. I just wanted to watch it of curiosity, because it was going to be a good fight. So I was a little bit surprised how it went, but you know, sometimes boxers have off days. So I don't know.
Definitely.
It was an interesting fight, though.
All right, we got Osiris Boxing. What's next for you in terms of opponents? Would you like Chisora?
Why not?
Why not? Steve in Chicago, congrats on the upset. What are your plans for your next opponent? Who do you believe is the most skillful fighter in the current? Oh, you kind of answered all of this already, so quick shout out. I guess you can answer.
Thanks for the congrats.
Yeah, exactly. We got Jemmy in Delaware says, congratulations, man. No one thought you were going to win. How does it feel to prove everyone wrong?
It feels good, you know. I can't blame them either way. You know, I've been doing bad performances before. I haven't been right in my head, and I've been sick, and I have had a lot of injuries and a lot of struggle with the mental, so you know, I felt like this was the first time in many years I felt good before going to a fight.
Man, that's amazing, man, that you are that type of a guy. That shows your character, bro, that you can say, look, I'm not mad at anyone because I know I haven't won. You know, like, I mean, just everything. I understand that, and I value you even more now. Last question, you're done with us. Coyote in the UK says Deontay Wilder came out and said if he retired now, he is a Hall of Famer. Do you think Wilder is a Hall of Famer right now?
Yeah. He's a legendary boxer already. I think he has... How many fights does he have as a heavyweight champ?
10 defenses, you know? And 44 fights, I guess.
Yeah, he's a good fighter. But probably I would put him there.
Well, Robert, that's all our questions, man. We want to thank you, obviously, for coming back on after getting the big win and not getting all fancy on us now that your phone's blowing up. Thank you. Thank you.
thank you for having me, man.
Nah, man. I appreciate it, man. You put on a fantastic fight. Like I said, look, Adam is a big friend of the show, so it was bittersweet. But, upsets are boxing. Like, that's part of the sport. That's the beautiful part of the sport, that one punch changes everything, and that every guy needs to be valued because you just never know what happens when that fist lands and everything connects. But, man, thank you so much for the time. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you. Can, please give out any social media so anyone who isn't following you can do so.
Yeah, Robert Hellenius. Hellenius Robert, hashtag Robert Hellenius on Instagram, and Robert Hellenius official on Facebook.
All right. Well, Robert, man, thank you once again. And enjoy the rest of your day, brother. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Robert Hellenius, thank you so much for coming on. Thank all the listeners. Remember, you can absolutely listen at 100% free by calling in 1-425-569-5241. We have plenty of people on the blog talk, and it is a decent experience over there. And that was a great interview. I love when guys.
Did the name update?
They sure did. They sure did.
Okay, good.
I love when guys, get those big wins and they don't get all fancy, man. They don't get all brand new on you, bro. He came right back, man. So we got a 10 o'clock schedule with Lennox Allen. Let me see if he even texts me back because I sent him a reminder. Got nothing on that. Damn,
I agree. I think that it was so awesome for him to say that he didn't blame anybody for not picking him, that he didn't blame anybody for being so shocked that he won. He was a 900. He was a plus 900 in that fight.
No, that was one of the best parts of the interview. The fact that he said that, like, look, I ain't mad at nobody. I know I've been fucking up. That was wow.
Yo, but that carnivore diet, that's the real deal. Like, I think Joe Rogan did it for like 2 months. Mark Bell.
No, but it's funny because he doesn't look like. Look, this is his fight night. Like, he's perfect shape in terms of lean and no fat. Like, I would trade my body for his, but he doesn't strike me as that heavyweight. Like it. Like the diet. Like all I'm saying is the diet didn't look from the naked eye as if it added anything. Like when Wilder went into the ring with Fury, he looked physically bigger. It didn't work out for him, but he looked bigger.
Well, the thing is that the carnivore diet specifically is supposed to, it's supposed to help you maintain body fat. So he probably lost some really important pounds that don't just come off with exercise. People got to understand, like, it doesn't matter how many rounds you put in the gym. There is a limit to the way that you can burn fat. Fat will burn over time, but it's not something that you can target necessarily. With the carnivore diet, it is something you can kind of not necessarily target, but the fat falls by the wayside. And it's supposed to help your mental dexterity. It's supposed to help your consciousness. I'm not conscious. I forgot what it's called. But basically, like, your ability to, like, be aware, like, your surroundings. And it's just supposed to open everything up and keep you
focused. Damn, if that's one of the myths, he might have proved that right, because he stood aware enough to catch that shot, bro. Like, he caught that shot, and it changed everything. It really did.
Yeah, I've been thinking about getting on it, honestly. My cousin Adam, you remember Adam, he's the one who's done music for us in the past. He started it, and, dude, he lost weight in, like, 2 weeks. He's, like, and specifically around his stomach, just like Robert was saying. And so that carnivore diet looks real deal. It's just, damn, dude, that's expensive, you know, right? I mean, all I can imagine is just, like, eating steak all the time. But I guess you could do ground beef.
I mean, it's not expensive. I mean, like, if you go to a butcher shop, you know, and you get, like, what Spanish people call una bola de you know, de carne, like, $40, $50
order
worth of
yeah
beef is gonna be a couple of pounds, you know. It's gonna be big, and you have them slice that, you know, 6 to 8 ounce steaks, or however you want it, pepper steak, ground beef, whatever it is you're gonna do. It's definitely not that expensive, you know what I mean? I mean, if you don't, I'm a meat eater though, so it's always been part of my, like, shopping list. You know what I mean? So
the one thing they say, though, is when you start the diet, the first week is like torture. You feel like you have the flu. And that's why I'm asking.
But why?
Ask
I don't even understand. Like, what?
They said it takes a while for your body.
What are you
to,
not eating? Because he said he's eating you're not, meat and eggs.
Yeah, but yeah, it's very rare. See, he said he's doing a version of the carnivore diet. In the carnivore diet, you're really. You can only have eggs and milk, like, every once in a while, and but no carbs. Like, the carbs, like, that's the big thing. Like, you got to understand, like, that's what gives you energy. That's what gives you, you know, the ability to get into the gym and stay there for, you know, an hour, hour and a half. Like, you know, without those substances and the nutrients that come from all those other types of things. And you don't eat a ton of greens. Like, you don't eat a ton of greens. So, it's definitely – the body takes a while to get used to. But, yo, that's a ringing endorsement for the carnivore diet, a ringing endorsement. A fighter who admittedly has not been his best version of himself in the past to be on that diet and talk about how it helped his overall – his you know, recovery, because that's the thing, is he has been dealing with injuries over his career. You know, when he had first burst on the scene, we had talked about this, you know, Max Kellerman thought he was one of the best heavyweight prospects out there at the time.
Emmanuel Stewart is on record saying that if he could get his mental right, he'll be undisputed. Mm-hmm. I didn't even know that. I thought he just said that about Wilder and Fury, but that same interview obviously was longer, this floating out there. And as soon as Hellenius beat Big Baby, the internet is undefeated, and that shit surfaced. I said Big Baby. I meant to say as soon as Hellenius beat Babyface. Listen, so it looks like Lennox Allen is sleepy time or working, because you know some of these guys are blue collar. So what we're going to do is we're going to go out to our callers real quick. You know, this show is Patreon only, so there is really no sponsors, but you do understand that, you know, El Camino's been there from the beginning, so we could actually never, you know, never not promote them because they've always had our back. And also, in 7 days, these will be public and, you know.
These calls are brought to you by El Camino Electrical Services, experts in electric vehicle charging stations. For consultations and turnkey installation, visit us at elcaminoelectricalservices.com.
Remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Drop those 5-star reviews and continue to help us be the number one boxing podcast globally. And continue to help us get these great named interviews. I mean, again, very thankful for Mr. Hellenius to come back on after the win. I've been in this business long enough to know that, you know, sometimes when a guy wins, you might never hear from him again. That's just the way that it is. But love his character. Cannot say anything negative about that. Mario 704 is a ringer. That's Josh. It should be Josh. I don't think you have that there. Josh in North Carolina. Just so you have it on your end as well. And we're going to go out to Boomerang in the ATL. You want to give me a flash? Because normally you just listen and intrigue. If you're not listening, you should, maybe you should give me a little flash before we go through the whole spiel. All right. Well, he's ready.
Riding in the form with a form, four Giannos on my feet, and the paint look wet. Every corner that we been, there's another broke net. Rolling through the city, swag game on full flex. I know you see.
What up? What up? Intrigue the Incredible. Good morning. How are you? And he's just listening. Yo, didn't I just say that? Throwing jazz at you. That's me throwing jazz right now. Let's go to Ringa in Chicago. Steve, good morning.
Yeah, hey, good morning, fellas. How you guys doing?
Oh, we're good, brother. Happy to have you.
All right, man. Yeah, as far as Eddie, you know, I don't pay much to attention. Eddie always talks to keep himself relevant and everything. So I'm not going to comment too much on that. But as far as what you were talking about, like fighting, and I don't know if you saw, I posted an article where Bob Arum was saying he could have the Inoue fight just in a TV studio. So you know how you guys were talking about how they might start up?
Yeah.
But maybe with audiences and that.
I mean, but that's all going to depend on the state and the location that is allowing the most occupancy, right? Because yesterday we had Jerry Forrest on. If you haven't caught that episode, I know, Steve, you were live on it, so you probably missed this part. But anybody can go back and check it out right here on Patreon without any ads, on the audio version only. Just check the post. It says audio only. So he basically said that without friends and family, you know, you're looking at about 200 people. And right now, most states are like at a 50-person occupancy, gets shut down. But, yeah, he said if you got 10 fighters on the card, you know, that's 20 people right there. And then you got the crews of the fighters. Then you got the television crews. You got the promoters' crews. It's just too many people. Right now, occupancy is like you can't have anything like that. All these stores are shutting down. It's pickup only, delivery only. So it's going to be difficult. I don't know. Unless they have some sort of remote controlled studio, right? Like set up the studio, the fight, let's say in one building of 100, I'm using air quotes, 100 person occupancy. Then all those cameras are fixed and or motorized, but remotely controlled from another building with air quotes again, another 100 occupancy. But yeah, to get it done in the same room, oof, highly unlikely.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying.
I think it's like we were just saying, Steve. These guys are just talking to keep stringing us along. But how the hell could they tell us, oh, I'm pushing it to July, if you don't even know when the vaccine's out? How do you know that it's going to be any better in July? It could be worse. It could be spread even faster.
I don't pay that much attention. That's what I was saying. Yeah. We'll see.
All right, brother. Well, you already know. Thank you for calling in. We're going out to Ringa in North Carolina. What's going on? Josh, what it do?
What it do? What's going to be with you next?
Man, you already
Mario, know. Anthony, Joshua, Alexander, Usyk, McGill, what it do?
What up?
What's up with y'all, man? Well, what Eddie Hearn talking about? He might skip pull-up and Fury be a priority. What are you talking about?
Yeah, that's what he's talking about again. That's what he's talking about again, man. He acting like he...
My Lord, that man.
Yeah, exactly.
He won't shut the hell up. Everybody just love to talk. I'll give it to Eddie, man. Even though he's shicey and all that, man, that man, he promotes something. Man. He be doing a little promoting. I don't know. Man, I'm just... This junk suck, bro. Ain't nothing going on. All y'all can do is report on news and all this stuff, man. I'm like, dang, bro. I want something to get to a resolution so we can get this boxing back on deck. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
That's crazy, man.
I feel you, brother.
Yeah, man. I'm glad it's kind of messed up that y'all got to go straight to Patreon, but y'all got to do what y'all got to do, man. These cheap bastards out here being cheap and trolling, being
trolled.
Well, yeah,
but don't forget,
that,
YouTube shut us down for the next 2 weeks. We can't post. We can't even use the stories. We can't use the community. There's nothing we can do. We can't even upload. So it's not like I could record the podcast and then upload it. It's nothing for 2 full weeks.
What they flag y'all for?
The same thing, man. It said regulated goods with no explanation.
Oh, man, somebody just hate. Yeah. Well, y'all keep on dishing out that content, bro, every day, man. That's why I respect y'all, man. Y'all stay on y'all grind. Y'all keep doing what y'all doing. I hope we get some more people so we can get Mike back on.
Definitely. But, well, don't forget to listen to yesterday's episode. Mike was there on Thursdays. He did the whole evening show with us, so definitely check that out. But you, Josh, you're a ringer. You are already supporting us, so nothing changes for you. The only thing that changes for you is that you're going to get more value for your patronage on Patreon. Now everything goes through Patreon. You can also find the show audio only, no ads over there. You'll find it video. There's going to be polls. There's also all the questions, obviously, to ask every one of our fighters. But even press releases, I mean, we put out the Roger Mayweather press release the day of it with a long story from the Mayweather. So, you know, you're going to get more content. Right. Hopefully Mario gets his writing back and we'll release his articles there first as well.
All right, then, man. Salute to y'all, bro. And I'll holler at y'all tomorrow.
For sure, Josh, man. Thank you for tuning in, as always. Now, Josh is a ringer, but he's using Blog Talk. Remember, the show is still free to anyone that wants to call in on Blog Talk. I got to remember to repeat this because right now it's really only Patreons listening until the 7-day theory, like Machiavelli, when we return for free on iTunes, TuneIn, Stitcher, iHeart, Spotify, and all that good stuff. So, you know, this episode is Friday. You'll get this next Friday, right? So let's see. Today is the 20th. You'll get this on the 27th, all right? On iTunes, TuneIn, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, Spotify, all that good stuff. Or you could just tune in live right now on Blog Talk. We're trying to get some more scheduled guests, but for the 26th, we got Ronald Ellis. I'm waiting on a date. I didn't put it in the calendar and then double book the IBF and WBC unified champion Jose Ramirez in 140 pounds. I booked him at 5:30 West Coast, 8:30 p.m. Thursday, the 26th of March. But we're going to get the clearance to bump Ellis to either 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock Thursday. The reason we want Ellis, he's 17-1 and 11, and he's now in his third or maybe even more camp with Canelo. And you know I'm a Canelo fanboy for JT and J-Mac, you know what I mean? I didn't take your wrench, Brandon. Remember, this is a different channel, man. But really, there's no need for wrenches, man. Check that chat out, brother. There's nothing but cleanliness there. You know what I'm saying? Nothing but sane, cool callers there. But let me remind you at 11, if we can make it. So, you know, hopefully we get some more callers and some more good old boxing talk with the people. Because if we can last to 11, we got Edgar Belanga scheduled. You know, he's a... I'm going to find out. I hope he tells me, like, nah, Ness, I was running. You know, and it's not that he's sleeping. But, yeah, Marlon Sims. Yo, my bad.
The one thing I did want to say is that a lot of people have hit me up on social media about doing the fight, about doing the, like, us watching the fights like we used to and calling them. I know Info Joe has been talking about it, too. I'm going to go ahead and say that, you know, we just start taking suggestions on Patreon and then set something up for, like, what was the days that we usually did them? Monday? No, that
what,
was
what, Film Study Tuesdays?
Film Study Tuesdays, that's what it was. Like, man, it was so it had a good ring to it. So, I mean, maybe we should just put, like, a poll out. I'll come up
with,
like,
five
fights. Yeah,
no, we could definitely put a poll out. But the thing is, You're going to do 24-hour poll, or do you want to do a poll today for next Tuesday? You know, like, put out Tuesday's poll for Tuesday, and then we catch up. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, let's do it like that. Let's do it like that.
Because, honestly, I know 24-hour polls won't have too much success. You'll get a couple dozen people because the show isn't, you know, I'm still answering messages daily. Like, yo, I'm on Patreon, but I don't see the show. And it's like, yo, it's at the top. Here go, and I'm sending people the link. So it's going to be a learning curve. You know
okay,
what I mean?
Okay, yeah, we'll definitely do that. I'll come up with five fights, and we'll vote on them. And then, look, I mean, even if, like, we do, you know, Tuesday, and then if we're going to do another show, like, on Wednesday, maybe we could take the second place show, or Thursday, or Friday, or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, we don't have to do just one, but we will have it for you know, for the Tuesday show. So, yeah, I'll come up with the fights. I'll send them to you, and then you post them, and people vote on them. Because it seems like that's really, like, people that are really bummed about the boxing, it's like, to them, the alternative is like, hey, let's watch boxing together. We can score it, and it gives a new dynamic. You know what I'm saying? And so
I just don't want to do, you know, no troll fights. You know what I mean? Where it's going to be more – because, like, I think we did – what fight was it that me, you, and Mike did? And I felt like he was lying about his scorecard. Like,
we did Fury and Wilder, and then we did Khan and Peterson.
So then it was you. It was me. You lying about your scorecard. And, like, I'd rather do real fights that we're not going to
– There's no bias.
Yeah, that we're not looking to lie, you know, to help our guy out. Like, just score the fight, just watch the fight. Like, I actually had an amazing time watching Holyfield fights. Maybe we should watch some old fights.
Oh, that was fun.
Holyfield, I think it was Holyfield. We watched Holyfield, maybe Foreman, or I don't know who.
I think we did. I think it was.
But it was crazy. It was an amazing fight. And
and it was fun watching it with everybody.
Even if
we
go,
we were getting.
Exactly. Even if we go to, like, the BWA's website and see the last, you know, 10 fights of the year. And go check them out, you know what I mean? Even though I know that those lists are pretty biased because, you know, you got to get punched a lot for to be in a fight of the year. It's like, if it's not back and forth, it's not fight of the year. It's never fight of the year when a dude Mayweather Canelo's you, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and you know, and what would be cool too about it, like, we could do this, right? And it's like, you know, what a 12-round fight, like the showing is like just over an hour, right? So, like, because usually they do the
That's
walk-ins,
right.
The rings. So then we could take callers during breaks and rounds. You know, oh, how'd you score it? Not a bunch of callers, but maybe one or two. Like, okay, what's your score? Okay, what's your score? You know what I'm saying? Like, every round. You know what I'm saying? So we'll keep the interaction going for sure. It won't be this closed-off thing, which I like. I like that a lot. I feel like people are in my house watching it, which my favorite thing about boxing is watching it with people.
Hell,
you know?
Yeah.
The excitement.
Hell yeah, that's why I love Border Wars, because after the fights, bro, you be with like 30 hardcore boxing fans, man. The conversations be crazy all over. Real quick, King Nello said it was the Manny versus Horn fight. That's the fight that Mike was stunting on his scorecard to give Horn the win to back Crawford. And that's what I'm saying. I don't wanna do those type of fights. Like if people people gonna laugh and oh no, that's my car, but you could tell in your grin that he's lying. Like I'm not, you know what I mean? I'm not wasting an hour scoring a fight legitimately just for you to back your guy. Like, so I'd rather do some old fights
so
where nobody got a
Nello,
dog in
so
the race.
So if we did Canelo Lara, you would give us a fair card?
I would actually love to rewatch it because when I watched it, let me tell you something. When I watched it, I had a Canelo bias. I thought he was a fraud, remember? So it was like, bro, this dude ain't fight nobody. Then he finally fought Trout and fought Mayweather. So I was just like everybody else, like, man, of course he gonna fight Mayweather. It's a payday. You know? So after Mayweather, it was Laura, and Laura was a tight fight back then to me. Now Canelo's, you know, elevated in my mind. Let's see how these eyes now receive that fight. Do I still see it as, because I thought Laura won. I felt like Laura got robbed. Like, not robbed, because you got to do enough for it to be a robbery the way Paul Williams and Slandry Laura went. Laura did robbery. Enough. Laura did enough to merit the first and only.
I love the way you put that. I love the way you put that.
Yeah, dude, because look, he did enough to merit the first and only, like, forever indefinite suspension for those three judges. Like, right now, people don't even remember that because, again, boxing fans are fickle. But, like, that fight, those three judges can't judge no more. That's how bad of a robbery it was. So when you make it that obvious, you know, you don't really get robbed. And that's why no one ever brings up Paul Williams' win over Laura, because, please, that shit didn't happen. We watched him get his ass kicked on TV. Then Laura robbed Molina on TV. Carlos Molina, man. Carlos Molina. He's fucking got deported.
I forgot about that, bro.
Yeah, homie got deported.
Fuck,
and
man,
shit.
I miss fucking boxing on Friday nights.
I bumped into Carlos Molina in Mexico, and he looked great, man. You know.
Did he really?
Yeah, he looked great. He looked great.
Wow, that's so good to hear.
Yeah,
I'm
no,
so
he's
glad.
Fighting. I remember, he took a few fights. He took a lot of fights. He's still, like, active. And I think he's moving down to welter or some shit. He was at the convention because he was trying to get ranked, I believe. Like, it's not over for him, you know? I hate bringing it up, but for those that don't know, you know, Molina got deported for some sort of sexual assault. Right? Was it something like that? Definitely,
it was something like that, yeah.
Definitely something with a sex and a woman and not being able, you know, not rape, but some shit. You know what I mean? Because he was a cool guy, you know what I mean? Bring and restore the balance. This is why Rap and Combat is here, to bring and restore the balance. Really, really. Mike made us watch that horn fight to solidify Bud's resume. Exactly. And then he couldn't because the rounds weren't saying that. And that's what I'm saying. Let's not waste our time, but... speaking of wasting time, I'm wasting yours. Plus, we got a boomerang on the line. We're going to go out to the United Kingdom.
Sing along if you know the words. Come on.
Yo, what's going on, Ness?
What's going on, Mario? What's happening, people?
What's happening? Good Friday. It's a good Friday.
Sure is, man. Bless up.
Yeah, listen, Eddie's just doing what he does, man. Let him do his job, man. He's the best promoter in the business. And he's keeping hope alive for the Undisputed fight. And correct me if I'm wrong, doesn't Undisputed Trump mandatories, isn't it?
I mean, it trumps mandatories. It doesn't trump rematches.
Yeah, but you never know. Maybe Wilder doesn't really want that third fight. Maybe they're just pressuring him, right?
Or maybe you're just hoping and wishing.
No, but did you say the same thing about AJ not wanting the rematch
I did say that, but look, Wilder came out and already said he activated his managers and handlers actually activated it. So, you know, that's just a waste of, like, airtime.
Yeah, listen, we all know what Al Heyman is. He's running the show behind the scenes. No way. But yeah, man, this COVID virus, man, it's just ruining things for everyone, man. Oh, man, so dead.
I mean, thank God for Eddie, though, honestly, and I'm not even being sarcastic. Like, we need people like Eddie that can give us headlines because, you know, there's nothing. We have no boxing. So we need something.
Exactly. And imagine if we get Undisputed. I don't even mind watching, even if it means that they fight in some included place, wherever. If we can get Fury and AJ in the ring, that for me is that makes it worth it, isn't it? And it's a good thing that, you know, the Wilder.
I mean,
Fury
we know that Fury and AJ is not gonna happen, though, man. Like, AJ doesn't take tough fights. He had the, like, I don't understand why all of a sudden now y'all want Undisputed when AJ had the opportunity to fight Fury forever. He's from He's from
you never had. You never had the opportunity. Remember, Fury was off for a long time.
Bruh, who was the first promoter to send Fury offers? He didn't lock him in. Yeah. He didn't lock him in. It's not our fault. What you mean? Eddie sent him an offer and Tyson put it on blast. We all see
it. Yeah, exactly. Tyson Fury didn't take the offer.
Exactly.
If someone sent
He didn't sweeten it.
That means the one to fight, right?
No, 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 no. If you send slave contracts, people are going to ignore them. That's what Wilder did. That's what Fury did. Bob Arum sent Fury an offer that he couldn't refuse. And that's why he no longer fights in the UK. Like, this stuff is so simple. But these UK guys love to make you reiterate the obvious. The obvious. Tyson Fury is happy in America because that's where the money came from. And that's why his fights are there. Undisputed. Is AJ gonna fight over here? Because they keep saying all out British affair. No, and Tyson got two more contracted USA fights, and right now USA is on quarantine with this corona, so that's gonna push it back, buddy. But I like that you're, you know, enthusiastic about the possibility. That your optimism is, you know, I'm optimistic a lot about the sport, so I can't knock you, man. We're going out to pro boxer. Marlon Sims got the win, 8-0. What it do, champ?
Man, how y'all feeling, man? I just had to hop on and just really congratulate y'all. I had to reactivate my Patreon and everything. So I just wanted to make sure I support y'all and hopefully everybody else continue to support. And I just, I'm just glad to tune back in and everything.
Oh, champ, man. Well, thank you, brother. We definitely appreciate it. But remember, man, you and anybody can always listen to the show for free right here on Blog Talk. I know you like calling in to Skype. You know, Skype is a little bit different. Obviously, that is going to be for the $15 level. But it's always going to be free here on Blog Talk, man. It's just a necessary evil so that we don't have to continue to, you know, lose Mike, Mario, and the many other people that I don't want to list again, but there's an episode out there where I list about a dozen co-hosts we've lost due to, you know, finances. So, man, now with this other flag, we got three strikes from YouTube. They're not just copyright. They're, you know, we're not just flagged. We have three strikes, so we're not even allowed to upload, do anything at all with the channel. We're like, it's like a lockout, you know what I mean? So it's just a necessary evil.
Well, let's show the hustle, man. Y'all keep pushing and keep going. I hope that this Patreon move really helps big time. You know, so is there a way, so me as a Patreon, I know you were saying that, so to share it but not share like the video thing, how do we do that so other people can,
yes,
you know, get on it?
Yeah, so from within Patreon, like when you go and click on the post, or before you know when you click on the post and before you click the actual video for the show, you'll see options to share. It's a little arrow and you'll see it within the app as well. If you're using the app, it's the three little dots at the top. It's the three little dots at the top. You click that and then it'll, you know, give you options to copy the link, share the link, and things like that. And that's where you want to share from within Patreon. And if you're not using the app and you're using a browser, well, then you'll see the little, you know, triangular arrow. It's like a directional arrow. And once you put your cursor over it, it'll give you the options to share, which are like Twitter, Facebook. Let me see what else comes out here. You get... slow internet. You get Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, and Pinterest. So obviously, you know, Twitter, Facebook are the biggest. So yeah, you can share it that way, or you can just, you know, use that link if you're on the mobile phone or, you know, the desktop. You copy that link and you can share that via text and stuff to, you know, people that you know want to listen to the show or should listen to the show. But yeah, man, enough of my Patreon commercial, champ. Well, talk to us, man. I mean, you got the win, And you were one of the lucky boxers that got to fight with no audience instead of having your fight canceled. How was that for you, not having, you know, the normal boxing audience there?
It definitely, I ain't gonna say it made a difference on my performance. I haven't even rewatched the fight because I just felt I didn't like my performance, so I haven't even rewatched the fight yet. But I don't know, it definitely felt a little weird because, you know, you can hear so much better, but I don't know, it just felt weird. It didn't seem like a regular fight. It felt like back in the amateur days, back when you only had just so many people there. That's what it truly felt like to me.
So, again, I consider you lucky. You got your fight off, you know, because right now no boxer knows what's next and when is next.
Exactly.
Yeah,
so I had another bout scheduled for April 25th, so we...
Marlon, repeat from April 20, because we lost you right there. You said you had another bout scheduled for April.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, I said I had another bout scheduled. That's for April 25th, but I think because of due to this whole corona thing, it ain't going to happen. So I am actually more grateful that I was able to get that fight on, because they were actually thinking about stopping the entire event one day before. So they was able to lobby and get it scheduled to where at least we could have at least some family members come in and watch the fight. And more and more right now to see how the whole sports world and everything in the world right now is shutting down. So I'm very appreciative to get that fight in there, because ain't no telling when the next time we're going to have one.
So what is the status of your gym? Like, or do you have your, you know, or is your trainer's gym his gym, or do you guys use, you know, what talk to me about the status of your gym.
So my trainer gym, we use a different gym, but my strength conditioning coach, he owns his own gym, but it's all closed, but I can get him to open it up if I need to go in there. Plus I got the keys to a different gym, so I can always go in there. And other than that, man, I got my bag and everything in my garage and everything, so I'm gonna put that stuff to use and just stay active, man, just in case something changed. I don't want to sit there and find out on the 31st that everything gonna be back to regular, and I ain't been sitting here putting in the work. So,
nah, for sure, man. So listen, champ, definitely, you know, take some wipes and some disinfectant with you. You know what I mean? Because you don't know who else they cool with letting them use the gym as well. You know what I mean? Just wipe shit down and make sure you stay safe, bro. Because like I said, you're lucky. You got the fight off. So at least you got one for this year. We don't know what the rest of the year going to look like, man. You definitely want to stay healthy. So as soon as things are back to normal, you know, you can be one of the active fighters that are not infected, that can actually fight. You know what I mean? It might help you more, you know, more than it's going to affect you, right? Because like, who knows who's going to stay in shape? Who knows who's going to, you know, be able to fight? So, you know, staying
healthy. Yeah, I just thought about that this morning. Like, man, let me go ahead and make sure I stay in shape, because other people probably not, you know, probably not doing nothing. So when things roll around, I want to make sure I'm already ready to go.
Not only that, is that they could give you the call now, because someone else's opponent could drop out simply because, A, they caught the virus. B, you know, they, because of the virus, they stopped training and now they're not available. So, you know, something big can, you know, come from this for you without you even expecting it. So, you know, just stay safe and stay in shape, champ. But anything you want to add to the topic
for sure.
At hand, or just listening?
Just listening, but I got one more question. So, you know, you have one of the listeners. He used to always ask about the appreciation. He always asked anybody that you interview about
the
appreciation.
Stainless. That was stainless.
Yeah, exactly. So, I was gonna put in when you do the interviews, if I'll ask them, like, put a question in there, asking would they be interested in supporting the Boxing Voice by, you know, I try to find a way to write it up, but ask them would they be interested in, you know, helping out supporting the Boxing Voice by doing like a $3 Patreon or something like that. Do you think that's something I should put in there or no? Or
dude,
you think it hurt? Or
you could totally put it because someone else, I think Mr. Sims wants to put it. Just make sure you put in brackets Mario or Mike Tyree because I'm a bit of a little wuss. You know what I mean? We went through that in the last episode. You know, I'm about, you know, Mario don't mind.
Nah.
All right, well, yeah, that's my call, man. Other than that, man, I appreciate y'all. Just keep going, and, you know, I'm still here, so.
Appreciate you, Marlon, man. You already know. We're going to keep supporting you. We're going to continue to promote you and, you know, really want to see you get an opportunity, man. You got, this kid's got some sides in that division. And, hopefully something shakes out for him. We're going to go out to the ringer, Cliff. What it do? Mario, write that down on your end. Cliff, what's going on, brother? Good morning.
Hey, what's going on? I'm not even sure what y'all are talking about. I just kind of plugged in about like 5 minutes ago.
All right, brother.
I'm listening.
No problem. We're going to come back to you, man. We'll let you catch up a little bit. We're going out to... Bond, wait a minute. Does Bond have an intro? I haven't heard from Bond in a minute. Let me see here. Do you have an intro, Bond Boxing? Holy shit. I don't remember. You're going to have to update me. What's going on?
Yo, what's up, brother? What? I don't have an intro yet. I'm going to get this together with DBS. I'm just going to have to switch over my credit card this afternoon so I can be back on Patreon. I had a little issue with my previous thing. But, yeah, no, I'm 100% down for this, you know, watching these fights together and shit. Because I'm out here doing fireside treatments. Because, as you know, I'm in the agricultural business. So I'm out here doing
fireside. Damn, Bond, I'm trying. I love you, and I'm trying. But that Bluetooth, it ain't it today. You sound like you're inside of a bottle. And then transmitting back out.
It was weird because it didn't sound so bad at first.
No? Nothing?
Can you hear me now?
Hell yeah.
That's way better.
Hell yeah.
Okay. No, man. I got to switch my card over, like I said. I'll be back on Patreon this afternoon. But outside of that, man, I've been out here dealing with this coronavirus. Hazmat it up, doing virucide treatments. You know, it's crazy out here, brother. But I'm 100% down with doing more fight, scoring fights together, man. One thing y'all know, I love Diego Corrales. I think one of the fights we should probably do is from our generation here is like Diego Corrales versus Castillo 1. I think that would be off the chain, one of the greatest ever. So... But I just want to touch base, let y'all know I'm still out here. I've been out doing these treatments and, you know, in this agricultural business, is, you know, I'm essential. So I'm out here fucking grinding. So, but still support y'all, and I'll be back on Patreon session.
Champ, man.
Yo,
thanks
listen,
for calling
Bond,
in.
Bond, you're a hero, bro, for real. You and anyone else listening and everyone else not listening that's actually doing these things. I saw this lady on CNN. She was the first person to volunteer to get stuck with the coronavirus with the vaccine. So she got stuck with it, you know, first. I mean, she's our guinea pig, you know what I mean? She's a hero, but Bond, man, for real, we all appreciate it. Thank you so much for what you're doing, because, yo, this shit got to stop. I mean, Bond's part of the team that's going to give us boxing back sooner. And I know that's kind of a superficial way to look at it. That's not really how I meant it. I just meant, like, us getting our lives back. You know what I'm saying? And that's what it is. I mean, even though food and shelter and all that's way more important, you know, a life isn't nothing without the shit that collectively makes you up, and boxing is a big part of that for all of us. So, you know, it sucks, bro. I'm not gonna lie, like, it's starting to hit every day, like, shit, that fight is supposed to be next week. Oh wait, you know what I mean? And that Hooker fight, damn, that sucks, dude.
Yeah, man, pushback season, bro. Something definitely did not expect, but just want to quickly remind everyone, or should I say, update everyone, Live updates. Let's see who we got. Got to get to some boomerangers here. Live update. We've just upgraded two more. So we got 316 now, right? Then we have 314 when we started, I think. Yeah.
I thought it was 14, yeah.
Yeah, so we got two more. 316. So we are on our way to that first goal. First stop, 500. Next stop, 700. We can do it.
Yes! Yes!
You know what I'm saying? Let's go on out to
that
the man.
Drive to five, baby.
Let's go. Let's go on out to that man that has been pushing, you know, Patreon more than myself out here in these streets.
Red belt, black belt, WO and green. I'm King. Undisputed GOAT, TBE. And you can catch the news first on TBV. Voice of the people, people now let me speak. Scientists of the sweet, B-O-X-I-N-G.
Yo, what up, though? Can y'all hear me?
Yeah, man. I know Mario hear you. I know he hear you.
Yo, you killed that.
Yo, that was my challenge to Mario. You remember we was talking about bars. He was like, man, I eat any of y'all up, man. I heard y'all calling my name. I'm like, yo. All right, bro.
It is Friday. It is Friday, and a certain number of Patreons wanted to make it Freestyle Friday, but I know Mario is the freestyle. I'm using air quotes. He likes to go right to freestyle.
Hey, just give them a heads up, man. My back car people know we was out there freestyling last Friday, and Stainless did, you know what I'm saying? I jumped in a couple times with him, but I had to let him have it. You know what I'm saying? I'm more of a trained professional, so I ain't want to do that to him. But Ness, don't forget, that's yours, man. You know what I'm saying? I just use it for my intro, but that song is completely yours. I've already done as far as my writer publishing and my copyright, my right lawyer, you know what I'm saying? I send that off to the Library of Congress in the next week, you know what I'm saying, for copyright. But that's yours, man. You have full freedom to use that motherfucker as ever you please, bro. So use that mud. Great interview with Robert Hellanius, man. It's good to see fighters come back on after they win. You know what I'm saying? Same thing to Marlon. So Icy Sims, I know he part of the TBV family anyway, but you know what I'm saying? When these fighters win, man, it's good to hear them come back on. You know what I'm saying? It sounds just grounded and humble as they were before they went out for the fight, man. So great interview, man. Great call with Robert Hellanius. I did hear Marlon Sims. Were you interviewing Marlon, or were you just talking to him like TBV? Because that's what we do over here.
Man, I was kind of interviewing him, man. That's what I've been doing most recently, man, because you gotta keep people updated. If we talk to him, just talk to him, people won't make the distinction that he's a fighter.
Yeah, man. Plus, you know, he got his ear closer to the street, so that's, you know what I'm saying? That's actually good to have that on our side, man. I'm going to let y'all get back to it, man. As I always say, please make sure you push the thumbs up and share this in every episode of the Boxing Voice Podcast. This TBV for life. And if you ain't on Patreon, and you probably ain't going to hear the show for another 7 days. And shout out to El Camino. Peace.
Wait, yo, before you... Oh, wait, then this is it.
Yeah, I'm there.
Yeah, I'm trying to find out, because you sent so many. I'm trying to find which is the long version.
I'll send it again.
Let me see. This is 6 megabytes. Oh, this 3 minutes. This must be it.
Yeah, more than likely. Yeah, that's yours, though, man. Do whatever you want with it. I sent it $1, too, so.
We're going to play
it. It's yours.
Oh, he's supposed to mix and master it or something?
I mean, it's already, you know, my guy, he mix and master in the studio during, you know what I'm saying, like during pre-production and everything else. That's why the sound's so clear. But, you know what I'm saying, I told him to put some of that Dollar DiBiase stank on him. I know he got, you know, all your sound bites and everything. So,
okay. You know what I'm saying? Okay.
You know what I'm saying? But like, yeah, I talked to Dollar like right after I left out the studio. Like when I was emailing you that song, I was already messaging Dollar through Facebook. So, you know what I'm saying? He got it too. But I let him know that's your song, man. You know what I'm saying? That's a Ness inspired song. Like you motivated me to do that much. You know what I'm saying? Because you kind of laid down a challenge without laying down the challenge. You know what I'm saying?
I definitely laid down the challenge because it's true. I mean, but I guess as I'm older, so that How to Rob album with 50 Cent or that song, like, that just is something that's part of my culture. So I just never understood why nobody never did that. Like, why nobody ain't make a rap including all these rappers, like, with punchlines. You feel me?
Yeah.
You got to listen to How to Rob to understand what I'm talking about. It's still.
Yeah, I'm old enough to know what you're talking about. But I'm going to let you get to these other callers, though, man. Mario, man. Peace, man. Good job, man. Thanks for sticking through, man. I know it ain't always easy, especially when everybody already painted you a public enemy number one and trying to put every excuse on you, man. But you stick with it, man. So, you know what I'm saying? Like I said, regardless of how I might have felt initially, man, ain't nothing like second chances. So we going to make this one right, man. Keep doing what you're doing, bro. You know what I'm saying? It's TBV for life over here, man. Peace, fellas.
For sure. Appreciate you, man. Thank you.
All right. Let's go to Keem in Florida.
El Gran Campeón.
Excuses tonight, Roy.
Let's not ask questions like that. Let's touch gloves and go to work.
Tonight, Roy.
Let's go to work.
What's going on, Ness? What's up, Mario?
Good morning, champ. What's going on? How's the weather out
not
there,
not much, man?
Make me happy.
Oh, it's good, man.
Oh, it's always good, man. It's always good out there.
Yeah, it is. It's getting hot, though, man. It's getting hot. The temperature today is probably in the upper 70s. It might be 80. It's kind of hot out here right now.
But it's sunny, good, though. Man. As long as it's sunny, it's okay.
Oh, yeah, of course. Sunny. Got a good breeze. You know what I mean? I'm looking right now. I say 77 where I'm at. And I'm in Oviedo. But, yeah, man, you know, weather's good. I've been out here working. You know, I do commercial HVAC work, man. So I'm all in these restaurants and at the hospital and at these grocery stores and, you know, working on all the equipment, man. So I'm all in the madness of all these people, you know, overreacting, trying to buy up all the shit in the stores, man. But yeah, nah, man, that was a good interview with Robert Hellenius this morning. I'm hoping we get, Edgar Berlanga on, fan of his, man. And I like what he's doing, you know, so hopefully we get him on and get to chop it up with him for a little bit. But yeah, man, I ain't really got too much on the topic that you had. Just listening in, man, trying to get all the boxing content I can get, man, while I'm out here working, you know what I mean? But yeah, that's that, man. Appreciate you.
Kim, you already know, man. Thanks for calling in. We never got the Caesar, but Caesar, you never press one. Don't know if you know. Now you know. And let me see. Looks like we got to everybody over there. So I'm trying to get Anthony Yard on, man. That has been difficult. And that's what I'm saying. After the big fight, it's like you don't know nobody. Yeah, I mean, that was Mike's contact, but I've been trying to work with Tundi to see if we could go and still get him. But no success as of yet. But I'm going to schedule Tundi as well, man. So if you guys got any interview requests, let me know on Patreon, and we're going to try and get those done. Like I said, I reached out to Haney and Bill Haney, man. I want to get them on. Let me text Berlanga because we got like 12 minutes before the time. But yeah, man, anything you want to add? This is what I said. If we get to 11, sometimes I feel like just canceling because it's, can we make it another 12 minutes and then got to wait for him to actually answer? Let's text him, though.
Yo, what I got to add is that song was dope.
Oh,
I never heard it.
Let's play the whole version.
Yeah, play that whole version. That's what I'm trying to hear.
I already got it down on here. Let's. We just got to make sure we level it.
And he has.
ain't ready for that. That beat, nice. I had asked him right. I said, I said, yo, where you get that beat from? He said, YouTube. I'm like, wow.
What?
Word. I'm like, wow. People out here putting out that fire. That's a nice beat. Let's bring it back in.
Yo, that was dope. I got what you meant now about the how to rob. At first, I didn't know what you meant because I only heard that clip. So I was like, wait, what does he mean? I didn't know he did it like that.
Yeah.
So that's dope.
But, yeah, man, you got to get it mixed and mastered. The vocals is drowned out by the beat. The beat is too deep. It's too, and it's I lowered it completely to like fucking 43. The bass is beautiful, though. Believe me, bro. When I first heard that, I was in the car, and let me tell you, I just had to even fade it out because he leaves like a minute and 20 at the end. And Jesus, man, it's like the intro. You just want to get into that beat. That beat is raw, man. That producer is talented.
You know what it is, though? It's not even that it's not mastered. It's not, the vocals just aren't mixed, but it's hard to do it with YouTube beats like that. Because like when you mix and master, you're mixing and mastering the whole product together, you know, whatever you put on it. When you get a YouTube beat, like unless the producer knows what he's doing and he's able to like, you know, break down the beat, it's just not, it's really hard to do that. That's why if you were ever like a fan of Texas hip hop, you know, like in the 90s and the 2000s, like, yo, the quality was garbage. Like, but it was dope though. You know what I'm saying? It was dope. Like Freestyle Kings, DJ Screw, Slim Thug, Chameleonaire, Flip, who got a new album out, Leprechaun 2 is dope. So if you ever like were a fan of that stuff and you heard it, like, yo, we used to get mixtapes at the flea market and they were just trash on the speakers, bro. Just, oh man, but you know, that was the thing though. So I can respect quality at certain degrees, you know, every degree, because it's important. Every notch is important. But yo, that track was dope for real. Shout out Stainless. That was really, really cool. I liked it a lot. Y'all need to ask him what that beat was, or like where to find it, because I didn't.
Like, what this is. Oh, tell me y'all remember that, bruh.
Yeah.
Bruh. Listen, again, if y'all going to do this, y'all got to listen to this song to truly get inspired. You know what I'm saying? If you smoke a J, definitely smoke a J while listening to How to Rob by 50 Cent featuring the Mad Rapper. He was, I don't know where he came from. I think it was a P. Diddy thing, but that song is crazy. You know what I mean? It's not like, it's just the way that they connect everyone in the rap industry to the song is what I want the rapper to do with the boxing industry. You know what I'm saying? Like, somehow find a way to include Bob Arum. Find a way to include Shakur or Vasil or something memorable that we know, I don't know, that happened. You know what I mean? Maybe it's Tyson biting the ear and you give me a metaphor, but you need to listen to the song. I'm not saying you ain't do a good job at all. I'm just saying what I wanted. And if we saying that's for me and this what you wanted, well, you need that to know how I want it to be created, you know? Because it's like he said, after it's done, then Dollar could add the necessary. It's on iTunes, Mario, so it ain't hard to find. It's on iTunes. But after it's done, Dollar DiBiase could add the necessary, you know, things that ad libs that we need to use it as that intro for the show. The beginning, instead of having, you know, Canelo, we got that, because who knows how it could come out. But that's the challenge, man. Freestyle Fridays, you know what I mean? Look, we got to everybody here. Oh, did I ever get the, I didn't get the Sid. What'd it do?
What up,
champ? How are you?
Hey, I'm all right. You know what I'm saying? Still out here working or whatever. And I'll be getting lost in that show, man. I just be out here listening. But shit, you know, big ups to what y'all did doing right now. Yo, what is the topic, man? I want to talk about it.
Joshua versus Fury could take priority over the Pulev, says Eddie Hearns. Plus, we're talking about Demetrius Andre and Liam Williams possibly going to the UK, according to Frank Warren, since the coronavirus.
Oh, so, well, I'm assuming that they still meaning after Fury and Wilder get their third one on. They trying to get that one going after the if the Pulev one get pushed back too far.
Yeah, because he's saying
exactly.
If the Pulev fight gets pushed into the past the summer, they basically not doing it. I guess they're gonna pace that.
Oh well, shit. Y'all know I always got some shit to say about AJ. You know that ain't good. But in this instant, shit, I'm with it because I don't want to see no Pulev, dog. You know, like no way, shape, or form. You know, I'm like, God, I'd rather see that. You know, if it happened, no matter who went out of that fight. You know, and shit, I don't have nothing to say about that second one, except if Eddie Hearn getting these shows on while everybody ain't got nothing going on, I got to get a man a hands up on that, too. You know, but shit, you know, shout out to y'all. I'll be updating my Patreon on Sunday. And yeah, man, I'm going to be here listening.
Champ, thank you for the support. Appreciate thank it. You for calling in. Yo, so obviously, we can't play the copyrighted music by a major recording artist like 50 Cent, but I feel like I need to say these words. Have you pulled it up yet?
Yeah, I could read the lyrics if you want.
Yeah, you're the boss, but not me. Let me see how good you do. Don't make me interrupt you if you fuck up this song.
Man, I don't remember like the song super well. I mean, I've heard it.
I know you just been listening to it over there. Get out of here. Hey, yo, hey, Stainless, he trying to get the heads up on you. I seen his face focused. He was listening.
I'm not going to lie. As soon as you said it, I was like, man, I'm going to go fucking do that. Yo, okay, listen.
And Intrigue, you a rapper too, man. I want to hear your update. He got that mellow flow, though. Well, at least so, in that one intro.
So it's like I'm just gonna start where the plug
start. Start from look. You gotta start from here. Like word. Hey yo, the bottom line. I'm a crook with a deal. If my record don't sell, I'm a rob and steal. You better recognize a nigga. I'm straight from the street. But I ain't on beat. I'm telling you right now. That's not how. Cause I can't play the beat. And you know, but with these words. If they could somehow make this into boxing, I'm telling you it would be fire. I'm giving y'all a platinum album. Now, I doubt platinum because the fucking boxing community is so small. But, yeah. Look, he said, I snatch Kim. Tell Puff you want to see her again? Get your ass down to the nearest ATM. I have dreams of fucking an R&B bitch, but I wake up early and bounce with all her shit. Come on, dog. Y'all remember this song?
Y'all, even that line,
I have dreams of, that's a song that you got to be as old as me to even know. So it's like a throwback, and that's what I'm saying.
Isn't that a Biggie song?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, what I'm saying is you got to be a little bit older. Like, we definitely got a young, I checked the analytics, so we definitely got 18 to 25 that probably ain't heard that.
I feel you. Okay.
But, I mean, rapping was just so different back then, man. I'm telling you. That was lyrical, man. I'm telling you.
Yeah, I see what you're saying, though. Like, I'm
look, about look, to look, look, look. Exactly. I was going to that line. Spit it.
I was like, damn.
Spit that line.
He said, I'm about to stick Bobby for some of that Whitney money. Brian McKnight, I can get that anytime. Oh, man, I don't want to say that word.
Yo, I'm telling you. Yo, he said, have Keith sweating, staring down the barrel of my nine. Since these Harlem word, nah, man. Listen, y'all got to turn it into boxing. That's all. Whatever. Let's see. It's 11:01. I'm gonna jump out. Uh-oh, my shit playing now. I'm gonna jump out and try and get Edgar Balanga. As you see, we did the best we can to stay on till 11. And I text him at 52. Homie be asleep. We going straight to the call on him. I'll be back.
Yo, I'm not going to lie. I was like, yo, I hope, I'm good to bolt because, yo, I'm not going to lie. I got some pretty good lines ready. Yo, me and Stainless could just hop on it together too if he want. I mean, I could do mine. I got my studio. I mean, not mine personally, but I got a studio I could record at. And, I got a line right now. I got to write it down before I forget. But listen, we're going to get all this stuff, too. If you're listening right now, well, obviously you're listening on Patreon, or hearing on playback, next week is going to be so much better for Patreon. You know, some of the stuff we've been talking about this week, on the back end, and some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. We're going to be more organized, you know, with the shows and stuff like that. So we'll have, you know, the Scorecard Tuesday shows and the Untitled Mondays, and you know, the Freestyle Friday thing could definitely work. That could be dope. You know, I don't mind. I mean, I can freestyle. Like, I don't mind doing that. I just, you know, if you go back and you listen to the two times that I rapped on TBV, like if you go back, just put like Mario Freestyle or whatever.
Mario, like, you know. Hate to go interrupt, ahead. But we got our third guest, Edgar Balanga, on the line. Edgar, how are you? Good morning. First and foremost, thank you for taking out the time to come on the show, talk a little bit of boxing, man. Happy to have you finally.
Good morning, my brother. Good morning, man. How's everything going?
Good for us, man, but I don't know that you can say the same. How are you feeling? Is your fight on? Is it canceled? What word have you gotten about your Madison Square Garden fight?
As of right now, everything's just been postponed and on hold. You know, I feel like in the next coming weeks, we'll get an answer. You know, so right now, I'm just taking this week off and just relaxing my body, you know, taking the time off for me, and then I'll be back in the gym next week. Well, if the gym's open, you know what I mean? But I'll be running and everything, start getting in shape a little bit.
So I want you to take us back to the beginning for people that may not know you, man. How did it all start for you? Why boxing?
It started when I was 7 years old. in 2007. My dad put me in the sport. You know, when I was young, you know, my dad had went away for a couple years, man, and he came home, you know, and he introduced me to the sport of boxing, man, at the age of 7. You know, within a year, I was already competing. You know, they felt like I had it. You know, I was just a kid that just had natural talent, you know, and, you know, from there, from that 1 year of me just being in the gym, man, they put me in tournaments, and I went undefeated. You know, I went 15-0. My first, like, 3 tournaments I won, and it took off from there.
So what was your amateur record when it was all said and done?
I was an 8-time national champ, 162 wins, 17 losses.
Damn,
so I had
champ.
A lot of experience, you know. I was in the amateurs.
What weight was that in?
I was in the amateurs, and I started my first fight. I started at 65 pounds, literally. And then I just kept jumping up, 65 pounds, 70 pounds, 75, 80, 85, 90, 95, 100, 106, 110, like that. I just kept going up.
So I seen that you had a fight in Orlando. I mean, I love what you've been doing with your own career, where you've been strategically fighting. But I want to take you back to, again, the beginning. I seen you had 3 Mexico fights. Is that you doing it on your own? What took you to Mexico?
I was signed with a different management, you know, and at that time, that was their movement. You know, they was moving a lot of fighters, a lot of young fighters out there in Mexico because they had the connections and everything. So, you know, I didn't really mind, you know, we was just building the record up, you know, and I was supposed to at least go over there at least 4 more times. But, you know, stuff changed and they brought me back out here in the U.S. And then my 4th pro fight, I made my U.S. debut.
So, if you could, when did you link up with Keith Conley?
I actually linked up with him a week before. Well, not a week, but I already knew, like, with Keith, you know, I was always buddies with him, you know what I mean? He was always my guy. And then we really, really linked up the week before before December 14th. And that's when, like, everything just took off, was, I think, December 4th or December 5th. And that's when everything took off.
But December 4th, what year? How many fights did you have?
No. It was just last year, before my last fight, before the December 14th, when I linked up with Keith.
Oh, so you was already with Top Rank
before? Literally a week before.
Was you already signed to Top
Rank? Yeah, I was already with Top Rank, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep.
So let me ask, and feel free.
The sport more stronger in the sport, and had more, you know, advantages in the sport, you know. And there was Keith, you know, and everybody was always talking about him, you know. And obviously, when he seen that I got with Andre Rozier, you know, he jumped on it, you know. He wanted me, you know. He was reaching out to a couple of people about me, and listen, man, you know, I knew I had to go with the best in the business, and that's Keith.
Beautiful. Listen, so where were you born and raised?
So I was born in Wyckoff Hospital in Bushwick, Brooklyn. And then, you know, I was raised in both areas, man. I was raised, you know, growing up around, you know, up to the age of like 5. I was raised in a Douglas Project. And then we moved over to Lower East Side, you know. And from there, I just, well, my mom lived. And then Pops is from Brooklyn, from Bushwick. So, and I was training in Bushwick as well, so I was always back and forth, Low East Side and Bushwick.
So no one is first generation Puerto Rico?
You know, my grandmother, my father as well. You know, my father was living over there in Puerto Rico. My grandmother from my mom's side, you know, and you know, my father's side, my grandfather and my grandmother was born and raised over there in Puerto Rico. And I have a lot of family right now that lives still over there in Puerto Rico, you know.
Beautiful. No, the reason I ask, just so you know why I'm saying this, because I see your fan base when you go to these fights. And, you know, obviously the New York City, Puerto Rican demographic, Latino demographic comes out for you. Even in Orlando, I watched some of your fights out there, and, you know, a lot of cheers, a lot of people there for you. And I was expecting you to say, no, I was born in Puerto Rico, and I lived there for a couple of years. Like, yo, you got a nice backing. What do you attribute it to?
Say it again?
I said, why do you think you have the following that you have?
Just for the simple fact that, listen, man, you know, I'm not a, you can see, you know, me growing up, I always repped the flag, man. You know, my first fight, I had Puerto Rican trunks on, you know what I mean? And I always loved my culture, you know, I love my island, and I love my people, and I love my family over there, you know what I mean? And I just love the flag, man, and our culture, you know, and just seeing Trinidad and me growing up and watching Miguel Cotto, you know, filling up the garden, man, and having the flags out, and I seen all the people and the day up before the parade, you know, it used to give me chills, man, and obviously I was a fighter as well, you know, so, you know, it's a blessing, man, to have that type of backing up, man, you know, Puerto Rico.
So talk to me about linking up with Andre. How'd that happen for you?
You know, as you know that, you know, I already knew Andre, you know, for a very long time, you know, and we had trained, you know, together, you know, with Curtis, with Saddam, with Collazo, Jadon, you know, you name it, man, and Danny. And, you know, I always had a good relationship with Andre, man, but, you know, I was in Florida, and, you know, those people wasn't really treating me right, man. And, you know, I told Dad, I said, Dad, listen, man, I want to go back to New York, man. I want to finish all my career where I started, you know what I mean? And that's in New York. You know, if you can make it in New York, you can make it anywhere. And Pops was on board, man. And, you know, we reached out to Andre, and Andre was like, yo, listen, nephew, you're coming to my gym with open arms, you know? And I believe after my August fight, August 7th fight, when Fat Joe woke me out, he was there as well, Andre. And I seen him there, you know, showed him love. And once I got back a week later, I was already training with him.
And what do you say some of the differences? Because you felt like you wasn't being treated right out in Florida. What do you think the differences are in being in New York, being with Andre, and definitely the level of sparring and you know, work that you can get in New York versus Florida?
Yeah, I mean, it was just living conditions, you know. And then I felt like, you know, I was gonna get stuck out there, you know, as far as me leveling up mentally, you know, and physically, you know. So when I got with Andre, a month later, he was willing to fly me out to Sergey, you know, for Sergey's camp, because he was training Sergey to fight Triple G. And within that month, I stayed out there with them for a whole month in San Francisco, you know, and I got the top work. And, you know, I was a little nervous because I was like, wow, I haven't seen his work in like 2 years, you know, being with the Russians, the people from Kazakhstan, you know, and these were top notch. Pros, you know, and listen, man, I held my own, you know, and I did my thing out there, man. And right there, I already told Pops, yo, Pop, listen, man, you know, we're going to go to another level because this man done been to that level already, you know. You see what he did with Danny, you know, Curtis, you know, he got Curtis to that level. You know, Curtis never become world champ, but he took him to that level, you know, Saddam. So I was like, he's been at that level before, you know what I mean? And I felt like it's not going to be that hard for him to take me to that level because of my discipline and how hard I trained.
Definitely, man. You definitely have piqued the attentions of a lot of people. So, I mean, an 8-time national champ, I'm sure everyone wanted to sign you. What made you decide on Top Rank?
Top Rank is the best in the business, you know, and I always said that since a baby, man. Me growing up, I always wanted to be signed with Top Rank for the simple fact that the greats was signed with Top Rank, you know. Floyd started with Top Rank. Floyd Mayweather, Oscar De La Hoya started with Top Rank. Miguel Cotto started with Top Rank. You name it, man. There's just a whole bunch of Hall of Famers that's retired now that started with Top Rank. You know, you see Lomachenko, he's with Top Rank. Terrence Crawford, he's with Top Rank. You know, and the thing with Top Rank, man, is they know how to build superstars. But not only that, they know how to build Puerto Rican fighters. You know, they know where to put them at. You know, how to promote them, you know, how to push that image, that brand, you know. And
I went with Top Rank, man. I was like, yo, listen, man. And they wanted me, too. You know, they was already hearing about me that I was making noise in New York. So it was just like, everything that I was doing was just icing on the cake, you know?
But when did you get with them? Because, I mean, your first three you did in Mexico. Then I seen you did a few Resorts Casino. So I'm assuming that was, like, with Real Deal Promotions or somebody like that?
I had signed, when I got out here in New York, you know, obviously I was with a different management, you know, and we went that route, you know, and everybody was talking crap, like, yo, why I get signing with these people, you know, with Real Deal and blah, blah, blah. But you know what, man? I had to take it on the chin, man, and I signed, and, you know, listen, it wasn't as bad as it seemed, you know what I mean? I made my name, I made my mark with them, you know, I was their blue chip, you know, they got me a lot of fights in New York, and I just built up a crazy fan base where I really put Top Rank on notice, you know, and, it came, I think, 2018, and I fell, you know, and there wasn't no more investors in the company, and they had me on the shelf, man, and that's when Top Rank took control, man. Top Rank was just like, well, listen, I want the Malenga kid. We want the Malenga kid. They kept pushing it, you know, and we wound up getting the release, and from there it took off, man.
Listen, and I'm going to echo what you said, bro. When I first looked over, I thought to myself, all right, the first three fights, you know, him and his pops, they did it out of on the muscle to get their name out there. Then you signed with Real Deal, and they put you in Orlando. And I'm like, that's good because that's a good Puerto Rican demographic out there. Then they took you to Queens, obviously in New York City. Again, good for your following. The next one, again, in Queens, took you to Philly. More, I mean, look, Danny Garcia loves to say Philly Ricans. So, again, more Puerto Ricans in Philadelphia. Back to Brooklyn again, the Garden, you know, back to Florida and Kissimmee, Philly. I mean, they marketing you in the right places, man. I mean, they're doing, you know, it doesn't matter who signed you at first and how rough things were. They still did a good job thus far. But you have been doing what you need to do with 13 fights, 13 KOs. I got to ask, man. Is there pressure to keep living up to that KO? Because these are all first rounders, too.
No, you know, right now I'm making history, you know, especially for the Puerto Rican people. You know, like they call me Mr. Don't Blink. They call me Mike Tyson, the Puerto Rican Mike Tyson. So it's cool, you know, but, you know, it's no pressure, man. You know, I'm in the gym, man. I'm working hard, man. I push myself to the limit. You know, every time that I get a fight date, I treat it as if I'm fighting for a world title, you know, because anything can happen in a fight, you know, and I don't take no one for granted. And whether they put a guy that I'm supposed to beat or supposed to beat, I'm going to take it as if I'm fighting for a world championship, you know, and that makes the difference, you know. And whether I go into the second, third, fourth round, I know I'm going to be 100% ready for that, man, because I'm in the gym now with future world champs, quick world champs, and, you know, just elite fighters, man, and I'm getting that them rounds in, you know, and that's the most important thing with me, you know, that I wasn't getting when I was back in Florida was rounds. And now I'm doing 10, 12 rounds straight, you know, three different spar partners, you know. So that's the thing that people don't see behind closed doors. They just think, oh, look at this guy, he's a first round knockout on his other. But they don't see the real, real Edgar, you know. And, you know, coming forward, they're going to see it.
I got to ask, champ. Tell me that you're working with Han D and he's your strength coach since you're with Andre Rozier.
Oh, man, yeah, he's amazing. You know, he did and then improvised with Andre. Man, Scooter is the best in the business, man. You know, and it speaks for itself, his work. You can see the people that he's done train. And he's currently training now. He's training Clarissa Shields now. She moved over to him, you know, so... Listen, man, Scooter's a great guy. Scooter took me to a whole nother level as far as physically, man. And I've never been this strong in my career, you know. And I'm a baby in the sport, you know. And it's going to be more and more dangerous, man. But Scooter's the best in the business, man.
Bruh, I got to ask, man. Where you get your swag from? You look like you could be a reggaetonero or something. You look like you could be a reggaetonero. Like you could do a fucking song with Anuel or something.
Listen, man. Since a kid, I've always been like that. You know, I want to tell you a quick story. You know, when my dad came home, you know, my mom was always dressing me fly, man. Always had me in a nice gear.
the nice shoes, the nice coats. You know, she always had me fly, man. Always had me with a haircut. And, you know, my dad winds up taking me shopping. He's like, yo, I'm going to take our son shopping. I'm going to take her to shopping. He's like, all right. But he takes me to a store, man, and he takes me to Outwears, you know, the cheap clothes and, you know, the cheap coats and the cheap shoes. And he see my face, and he's like, what's wrong? You know, like, I'm taking you shopping. I'm like, nah, I want to go on that side. And it was the fur coats, the Jordans. I don't know if you remember the Pepe jeans.
Hell yeah, Rockaway, I remember Pepe jeans.
You know, and he was, oh, no, man. He was like, nah, this kid is, oh, man. He called my mom, like, yo, man, what you did to this kid? You know, I know about all these name brand stuff. And he's only 5 or 6 years old, man. She's like, what? You know, I'm always dressing him fly. I'm always making sure that he looked good. So I guess it started from Mama Love, you know, always making me look good, feel good, you know, with the haircuts and everything. And I grew into that, you know, and I always like to look good and wear my shades and have my, you know, my hair cut. So I guess, you know, Mama Love, meant that, you know.
Nah, miss it. Listen, you what New York needs, I'm telling you, you keep doing what you're doing, the garden is going to be yours. I'm telling you. And you're right, man. Top Rank knows what to do. They know how to build stars. They know how to build prospects. And so far, so good, man. I definitely got some questions from the people. But before we get to that, actually, give us the Fat Joe story, man. How'd you link with Fat Joe, and how is he always so interested in your fights and willing to walk you out to the ring? Give us that background.
Oh, man. It's like a right now, it's like, you know, Fat Joe's my mentor, my big brother, man. I've seen IG going crazy right now because he just posted up me and him on live, and, you know, he was dropping a lot of knowledge on me yesterday night. But, you know, it started in August, man. You know, obviously I'm making noise. You know, I'm a Latino, you know, I'm Puerto Rican. You know, he's Puerto Rican. So, you know, I was making a lot of noise, man. And, you know, his management started following me on IG. And this was 2 weeks before the August fight. You know, they kept watching me, showing me love. So Top Rank winds up calling me and was like, hey, you know, you think you can have Fat Joe walk you out? Brad Goodman had called me. And I was like, you sure you want me to ask him? He said, what? He said, man, get that call, man. I was like, all right, see no more. And I got off the phone with Brad. And I wound up hitting up the manager, Rich Player, and he was like, what's up, nephew, how you doing? I was like, nah, man. I was like, listen, Unc, I know it's 2 week notice, I'm sorry, but is it possible if Joe could walk me out? He said, when's the fight? I said, August 10th. He said, I'm going to get back to you. He got back to me. He said, Neff, you got a show that same day. He got a performance. I said, damn. He said, wait, hold up. I'm going to call you right back. I'm going to make arrangements. Less than 10 minutes, he called me back. Your nephew, we're going to be in. We're walking you out. I said, what? He said, yeah, we pushed the performance up so we could be able to make your fight. I said, wow. And it started from there, man. You know, Joe came, you know, they kept their word, man. Joe came, he walked me out. We shut down Philly. It was crazy. When I say crazy, man, we shut down Philly. Man, I put everybody on notice with that. You know what I mean? And then Joe was just like, you know, talk, man. Listen, yo, Neff, I'm going to be behind you in your career, man. You're a special kid, man. You know what I mean? I started looking at you, studying you. You know, watching all your fights and your personality and everything, man. And he fell in love with it, man. And then, obviously, the December 14th fight. But I've even been asking. He called me. He said, yo, Neff, I need 4 tickets. I said, no problem. Got him before. He walked me out. You know, and then he was supposed to come for the March 14th fight. He was supposed to be out here, but it was his wife's birthday. So they were celebrating in Miami. But he had bought ESPN Plus, man. He had the whole family waiting for me to fight. You know what I mean? And he called me. He shot me and said, like, you're not fighting? I'm like, nah, they you know, they canceled the fight. He's like, oh, man. He was like, you have the whole family here, man. I ordered the ESPN Plus app. You know what I mean? I have wife cook and everything. I have the whole family ready to watch you fight. Now, he was like, hey, man. He was like, you know what? He said, with me not being there, they canceled the fight. He said, but you know what? For the next one, I'm there. And every other fight, I'm going to be there. As long as I'm not booked for any of those days or it's nothing important as far as, like, you know, my daughter's birthday or whatever, he said, I'm there. And, you know, he's a mentor now, a big brother to me.
Wow. Beautiful, man, beautiful. But I got to ask, I'm going to dive in a little bit deeper. What made you pick that song with Anuel and Fat Joe? Or did he pick it?
Oh, the Yes song. I mean, I picked it. You know, I did the Lean Back with him in August. You know, And then in December, he was already, the Yes song was already hot, you know what I mean? Like, he dropped that record, and that record was all over New York, you know what I mean? And then now you got Cardi B from the Bronx, you got Anuel from Puerto Rico, you know what I'm saying? He's Spanish, and you got the legend Fat Joe, you know? So it was just a beautiful song for that day, man, in the garden, you know what I mean?
Nah,
and,
it was.
You know, it was one of the hottest records right now at that time.
I felt the energy, bro. I'm telling you, I've been stalking you ever since trying to get you on this show. Like, bro, I felt that energy when you came out with that song. Yeah. I even tapped my girl, like, yo. Because right now, Anuel, Bad Bunny, they hot, but, like, you did it on a different level, man. I like it because, you know, adding Fat Joe, he's already a fight fan. And he got New York on Smash, so it's like, yo, he's blessing you to New York City, and you got this audience, man, really, really.
Mm-hmm.
And everything about you, you're checking all the boxes, man. I mean, if we would have maybe interviewed you 5 years ago or something, it would be a different story. But the fact that now you're with Rozier, you're also with Scooter, you know, you're also with Top Rank, your manager's Keith. It's like, yo, you're destined for a world title, man. So what is your trajectory? Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously the coronavirus, let's imagine this virus didn't happen. What did you assume 2020 was going to look like for you?
Oh, man. And I was talking about it yesterday, man. You know, the March 14th fight was so big, man. I had a lot of people coming out. People that I didn't even know from a hole in the wall was flying in from California to see me fight. You know what I mean? And it hurt me because, not for the money situation, because thank God, you know, I'm good financially, but it was just like, damn, this was another fight for me to step up to another level, you know? And I also have Mickey Woods walking me. I don't know if you know him. He's a Spanish
reggaeton artist. Of course I know who Mickey Woods is.
He's a big artist.
Of course I know
I had him
Mickey.
In the back, but I had him. He was flying in. He was flying into New York, man, on Friday. He was supposed to be there early. He was flying in, you know, and I called him Thursday night, like, yo, listen, cancel the flight. He was like, what? I'm like, yo, it's over, you know, and he was supposed to be walking me out March 14th, you know, and we was going to shut the garden down, man. You know, I just had so much people, man, and, you know, I had a lot of people that was going to be tuning in, big people that was going to be tuning in that day, you know, and like I said, man, for me, every fight that I fight, it gets better and better. My life gets better and better. My life changes for the better every fight, you know, so it was like, damn, what now, you know, and then we don't even know now what I'm going to fight, you know, so it's like, it's a little sad, man.
What's your long-term goal? Obviously, you know, you want to be a world champion, but what is your long-term goal for boxing?
I mean, I'll be a world champ, man, but also, you know what I mean? Save as much money as possible, man. You know, retired moms, retired pops, you know, invest my money, you know what I mean? But just save, man, save my money, man, so that way if I get caught up in a rainy day, something like this, man, I could be able to say, you know what, I'm good. You know, I could retire, you know, and I could focus on business. You know, because I feel like I'm not destined for boxing. I feel like boxing is going to open up doors for different areas in my life, you know, whether it is you know, modeling or getting into the movie industry, you know what I mean? It's different stuff, you know. I'm destined for greatness, man. So, you know.
So we ain't going to see you. We ain't gonna see you doing no features, cause you said modeling and movies. You ain't saying nothing about. I ain't hear you say nothing about dropping a verse with Joe or maybe a verse with Anuel.
I mean, listen, man. If you never know, man. If Joe give me a verse, a couple dollars off of that, you know.
For sure. Listen, we got a couple of questions for the people before we let you go. Antonio in Albany says. Question, are you more of a Danny Garcia, Miguel Cotto, or Trinidad in regards to how you will impact the Puerto Ricans and the Puerto Rican boxing landscape?
Come on, man. You got to – who I always talk about, Trinidad, you know? Yeah. Even though Cotto, when I was, you know, growing up too, I watched Cotto a lot, but I know Trinidad impacted the people – a whole lot, you know, he brought the island really together, you know, and he's a people's champ. And the island, him still being retired, he could go anywhere in Puerto Rico and they're going to show him love, you know, so it's Trinidad.
All right, we got another one from Caesar in Las Vegas says, good morning, champ. Excuse me. Good morning, champ. Thank you for answering our questions. If you could pick out of one of the top guys in your division right now that you believe you could beat, who would it be? And what flaws do you see in him?
Right now? What are we talking about, 160 or 168?
I mean, wherever you campaigning at, you already want to move up to 168?
Yeah, Benavidez. You know, I know he's a line, but you know what I mean. And I'm a young line too. You know what I mean. I know he got the title, you know, but I see myself being a lot of those fighters, man. You know what I mean. I feel like when I get to this, man, and I actually fill in and get into my grown man strength, I feel like I'm gonna be dangerous in that division. You know what I mean. And I'm willing to call on anybody because at that time, I'm gonna be ready for it.
So you're not campaigning at 60 no more because your last fight was at 64 and a half, but I didn't know if that was just because it wasn't a title or not.
Yeah, that too. It wasn't a title or not, but I spoke to professional athletes. And, you know, right now at 160, they got me ranked 13 in the world for the WBO. So, you know, I don't know if we're going to try. Well, my next fight, I'm going to try to push more down to 162. You know, with their nutrition and how they move and what they do with the world champions, you know, Terrence Crawford works with them, Teofimo, Shakur Stevenson, you know. I'm pretty sure with their plan, I can make the 160. It's going to be hard, you know. It requires a lot of discipline, you know. But I'm a big boy, and right now I have a lot of advantages at 160, you know. And I would like to win a world title at 160 and move up, you know, obviously vacate it, move up to 168. With a couple more world titles, and then eventually more to 175 when I'm older.
And you said you're ranked in the top 10 in the WBO at 160?
Right now they got me ranked 13. I don't know about the rankings now. That was like a month and a half ago. They had me ranked 13 in the world.
And, all right, so we got just a few more here. We got George Foster in the UK who says, who do you see as the top three guys in your division?
168, you got Caleb Plant, you got Benavidez, and then obviously you got the money man, you know, Canelo Alvarez.
All right. We got Jemmy in Delaware that says, what is your relationship with Fat Joe? And you've already answered that. And what weight class do you think you'll end up at?
Man, I want to win. Probably end up in cruiserweight.
Damn, really? How tall are you?
Depending on how. Depending,
you 6'1"?
Yeah, I'm 6'2".
Oh, 6'2".
6'2". Wow. 6'1", six, yeah, like 6'1 and a half.
Okay. Last question from Keem in Florida. Actually, it's not the last. A new one just came through. He says, thanks for your time, champ. All of the great fighters from Puerto Rico, who's your favorite? Out of all the great fighters from Puerto Rico, who's your favorite?
Trinidad. Tito Trinidad, my favorite.
And then we got Cliff and Clifton. Who in Jersey, who says, what weight do you tend to rehydrate to on the day of fight, champ?
I probably weigh like around 164. I'm hydrating up to like 182, 183.
Wow.
Possibly 184, you know.
Well, that is it. Mario, I know I kind of hogged this interview. You got anything before we let the champ go?
Nah, man, you asked everything I wanted to ask. I just want to say, Edgar, I'm a huge fan. Can't wait to see you again. And, yeah, I agree. I think all those fights are great and interesting. You know, they're going to be, you know, big time. So can't wait to see you again.
Definitely, man. Really sad that your fight
canceled. Thank you,
bro.
For having me on the show, man. I appreciate you guys.
I appreciate you, man. Edgar, give out your social media, man, for anybody that isn't following you, can do so, man. And we definitely want to make this a regular thing, brother. Appreciate you once again.
Oh, of course, man. You know that. Listen, man, you guys can follow me on my Instagram, Real Edgar Berlanga, on my Facebook, Edgar Berlanga, and my Twitter, Edgar Berlanga Jr. Continue to follow my journey, and I'm going to continue to keep fighting for you guys, man. Thank you for the love and the support, and we're going to be back in the ring soon.
For sure, Edgar, man. Thank you once again. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Edgar Berlanga, up-and-coming contender. Contender, not yet, but definitely trajectory of a contender for sure with the way that he's looking. First-round knockouts, but he is on 8 rounders only. But he's doing all the right things. All the right things. Hopefully you've been watching the live stream and you got to see his Instagram. Again, a boxer's Instagram, you know, appealing, drawing you in, has celebrities, helping him. You know, he's doing his thing. 13-0, 13 KOs. And even though he might have made some decisions in his career that he might not have been 100% happy with, like signing to Real Deal, brother, it just played out perfectly. You know, down to the fourth fight, you know, being in Orlando, then Queens, you know, Brooklyn, Madison Square. I mean, everything worked out perfectly to the point that Top Rank said, look, we need this guy because they need draws in New York City. They need that. When they bring Crawford and they bring, you know, Vasil, those guys need help to sell it, you know. That's why you see Teofimo's on there and the Adorno's on there and this kid on here. But I really like what he's doing. Impressive, you know. Obviously, Joseph Adorno was doing the same thing in a lower weight class, but he suffered a draw in his last fight. And we were trying to get him on the show as well. But really happy we knocked out all three interviews. There you have it, man. For a slow alleged boxing day, we brought you some fuego, because I'm telling you, this kid will get a world title. Because it's like I said, I got to reiterate, all the boxes are there. All the boxes. Amateur background, check. Bro, look, if we wanted to sign a fighter, an 8-time national, that's a shoo-in. If you got a kid that won 8 nationals, you sign that kid, okay? 8-time national, box check, all right? Puerto Rican? That means he's got a fucking following. Box check. Puncher? Box check. Dude, they killed it, man. They killed it. This is out the park. He would have to get knocked out for this to go wrong. Like, someone would have to derail the trajectory. Again, the right promoter? Box check. Because, it, look, PBC has plenty of dudes that they don't do what this kid is getting the opportunity to do. How many times do we scratch our head when PBC's putting fucking Jamal Charlo in L.A. when he's from Houston? You know? Then they want to say, oh, he's got a house in L.A. What the fuck does that matter? No, we're fighting Javante in Atlanta because he's got a house in Atlanta. Look, for Javante, it's probably a better reason. You know what I mean? I will ride with that reason because we all know in Baltimore he gets in trouble. Was the story they fed us numerous of times when he got in trouble. So cool, whatever, Atlanta. Plus, he opened up a new market that we've been dying, begging for. So Javante going there, I got no issues with. But they don't fight their fighters where they need to fight them. Top Rank knows how to do that. And he said that. Top Rank knows how to market Puerto Rican fighters. You know, the same way De La Hoya gets a knock for not knowing how to market black fighters, or Bob Arum gets a knock for not knowing how to market black fighters, you know, they also get a check for knowing how to market Mexican fighters in Puerto Rican fighters. You know, the Cotos and the Trinidads of the world, you know, Don King and Bob Arum, you know, Oscar, Bob Arum. So I think that if he just keeps winning, he's got it made, bro. He's got it made. He's got it. I'm going to be honest, though. I want him to lose that weight. You know what I mean? Because 168 is a big division. I didn't know he was 6'2", which makes it even more interesting. But, you know, he's floating at 160. He just got with Scooter. He's about to get this nutritionist. You might as well give it a shot at 160 if you could get a world title shot. And again, the box is checked, Mario. It's not
that's what I was going to say.
It's not just the talent. It's not that, oh, he's got the talent. No, he's got the talent. He's got the trainer. He's got the strength and conditioning coach. He's got the high-level manager. He's got the big-time promoter. He's got the swag. Look how well that interview went.
Yeah. No, and his Instagram, I mean, you just see it from top to bottom. This kid knows, like, he markets himself so well. And that's the other big thing. You know, we did that show the other day, ranking fighters 1-5, fighters on the rise that have the potential. And, you know, Edgar could have gone on that list. He should have gone on that list because it would have been very interesting to talk about him. It would have been very interesting to get everyone's take on him because there's just so much to like. And here's the thing. While I agree, I would like to see him drop – not even drop down to 160, but if he can make it for a couple years or even a year, you know, it's not like I'm asking for like a legacy there, just like a campaign, because there are fights there available that make sense. Well within his purview. So that would be great, but he's going to be a big guy. Like you can tell just looking at him, he's got, you know, he's got a lot of room to grow in. I mean, 6'2 is pretty big for the middleweight division. I mean, it's not big, but you know, it's definitely a decent size and he's got room to mature in terms of frame and his neck, his body. So this is just like a lot to look forward to. And at 22, I don't think he's capped out yet. I mean, listen, he's certainly not capped out in size. You know what I mean? So, I mean, this kid could be a light heavyweight one day for sure. But 13-0, 13 KOs. You know, the only question, and he touched on it, or you touched on it. Actually, it might have been a Patreon caller. One of the questions I had, but he kind of touched on it, was the 13-0, 13 knockouts, and the pressure. Because I've always wondered when guys
that was
that
me.
Kind of record,
that was me.
Yeah, that was you, right? Yeah.
And you know, his answer was amazing. His answer was that there was no pressure because of the change being, and that's what I'm saying. All the boxes being checked, like because he's with Rozier, he's getting, like he said, 10 rounds of sparring, 3 different sparring partners, high level sparring. You know what I mean? If you live in Orlando, Florida, you're not going to be able to spar Curtis Stevens, Daniel Jacobs, Saddam Ali, Richardson Hitchens, Sergey Dervinchenko, Marcus Brown, you know, everyone that goes through that gym. You just won't be able to do that. You won't. You're going to fly in sparring. You're going to have to pay at this level when you could just be part of the stable.
Yeah.
You guys don't understand how
beneficial
important that is, bro. Like to have the team is all there. Strength and it's not like we're talking 5 fights from now and he looked bad and it's like, bro, this guy needs to hire a strength and conditioning coach. We're talking about a 13-0 kid already with the complete package in a team. Advisor manager, big time promoter, big time trainer, big time strength and conditioning coach. Fuck, then you got celebrity backing. Bro, if you ruin this, you know what I mean? Like all he's got to do is just sit in the car and like my man Joel Santana said, don't touch nothing, get in the car. That's it. Because the trajectory, you know what I mean? The trajectory. If we could buy stock right now, I would purchase some in him. Because, again, there are no boxes on the negative side that say, well, Ness, this can happen. The only one that's there is the unknown. The unknown. We can't check that box. The chin.
You know,
we can't check that
box.
That
unknown comes with also, like, you're saying, like, get in the car and don't touch nothing. That's what you're saying is do the right things and you're going to propel yourself.
Exactly.
Here's the problem, though. When guys start to get to a certain level, it gets harder and harder to do the right things. More people are inviting you places. You got more friends in the circle. And I use air quotes when I say friends. You know, parties and clubs. And, you know, you kind of saw it a little – you know, I'm not going to say that. You these things happen, but Edgar's answer when you asked, like, you know, what are you going to do, like, when you make it, I think it was something like that, and he said save money was his second answer. You know why he said that? Because he grew up poor, because he's been homeless. You know what I'm saying? Like, this kid understands, and that makes it more likely in my experience that he's going to continue to do the right things.
I think that went over my head, bro. I could have sworn I heard him say, my mom used to keep me fresh and all the fly shit. And then my father came home and wanted to take me shopping. But I let it go. But I think he meant what I say when I say come home, which means come home from jail. Like, he just got out. Because he like, yo, because listen to the story. It went over my head at the time I was doing the interview. I was very excited to interview. I've been chasing this interview for a while. But at the time, I thought it. I just didn't release it out there because he said right after that, he said, my dad came home, wanted to take me shopping. So he took me shopping. So when we got to the store, he took me to the aisle where all the cheap stuff was at. And I'm like, nah, I don't want to go there. I want to go to that aisle where the Pepe's at. And he like, yo, you remember the Pepe? I'm like, hell yeah, I remember Pepe G.
Yeah.
So he said the father called the mother, like, I forgot the name he used. I can't remember everything verbatim. But he said, whatever, what you did to... you know,
what'd you do to him?
Edgar, yeah. he spoiled, he basically. He only
want, yeah.
So obviously there's a time gap there. What you did to him, like he could, she didn't do that shit overnight. She didn't do that while you said, I'm about to pick up my son. You know, I'm going to go on and pick up my son. She's like, okay, let me dress him. And all of a sudden this kid is in love with, you know, fancy thing. No, there must have been a time gap, but it went over my head to ask like, yo, your father was locked up, but it don't matter. His father's in his corner. And you know, his father's out, or if we're assuming, the
well,
point
those
is
things that make us, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like, listen, nothing makes a stronger man than a boy who was raised by a really strong woman. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And there's no, and it gets very, like, the strength it takes to be a single mom while that situation's going on. I mean, that's one of the toughest situations you could ever deal with as a child. So, like, you know what I mean? That's the type of stuff that carves human beings. It don't shape
them.
We're
going to get
them
back now. Now that we got them, you know what I mean? And we're going to be definitely getting them back. I think we got Antonio in Albany, if I'm not mistaken. Double checking here, yeah, because he got like 70,000 numbers. But Antonio signed up to Patreon. Salute. Champ! Antonio.
Yo, can you hear me?
We hear you.
Yo, good.
What up, bro? We asked Edgar Baraka your question. Yeah, we hear you.
Yeah, my fault, man. I just got into the show, man. I'm at work right now, man. But, yo, before anything, man, I just want to say that it's a great move for you guys, man. I know it's tough. I know I fucking miss Mike. No, like, seriously, man. But it's all good, man. You guys got to do what you got to do. You know, I'm here to support you guys all day, every day. And, you know, just keep grinding, man. I mean, just keep doing your thing, man. Like, Boxing Voice for Life, like, for real, man. If you really, like, stick it to there, like, the Boxing Voice for Life, man, I'm in it for the long run, man. And you guys are always with fucking good-ass content, you know, and so forth, man. But as far as the show, man, I know I read it. I actually saw the topic real quick on Patreon about Joshua and Fury. And you guys are saying that it might happen if the Pulev fight don't happen.
That's what Eddie's saying.
Eddie's saying that the Fury Joshua fight might be so important that Pulev's gonna have to take a back seat.
Okay. I mean, I agree with that just because everyone knows that's a big ass fight. But you know, honestly, yo, this whole fucking coronavirus shit, man, it's affecting hella shit, bro. I mean, I'm still at work, man. It's not affecting my work. But I do warehouse work and shit. But other than that, man, I don't think we're going to see boxing for a while, man. And it's crazy, man. This shit is fucked up right now. But honestly, if the fight does happen, man, I honestly see Tyson Fury being a Joshua, just boxing circles around him. I don't see him knocking him out unless, you know, Joshua's chin got weaker after that Ruiz fight. You know, we never know until he fights again. But other than that, I'm going to go back and listen to the... Oh, real quick, yeah, about the Patreon. So, can I download the podcast? Or
absolutely.
Do I have to listen to YouTube through Nest to Kids?
No, absolutely. So, the podcast, right? Like, if you go on Patreon on the app or the .com, all you got to do is scroll down, and it's always going to say audio only. And you click on it.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And it'll be an MP3, and it's downloadable, and you can take it with you. So even if you don't got service, plus no ads. So I know you've always listened with ads, right?
Yeah.
Long ads too, right? They long. They double ads.
Nah, yeah, I know, right?
They double
nah,
ads.
It's all good, man. Yeah, but
so
nah,
now
good
it's
shit
no
though,
ads,
man. Good shit.
Bro.
Just continue the grind. Yeah. Nah, yo, but, damn, I was going to say something else, man, but other than that, man, you guys have been fucking taking out shows by shows, man. I can't catch up, man, but that's what I like, because I'll be at work just listening to straight back-to-back Boxer Boys podcast, man. It's all
beautiful,
good, man.
Beautiful.
Just keep grinding, man, and you know, just, keep it up, man. That's what, man. Because the real fans will stay with you, man.
For sure.
Other than that, man, until the next show, man.
All right. For Antonio and anyone like Antonio, you also have a Patreon-only iTunes feed, right? So, like, every audio show that we upload, it should be on the Patreon-only iTunes feed once you grab that first one, right? Like, it'll create its own thing. It should be, like, TBV Patreon-only. I think it's called... Hey! My dog, get out of there. So, let's go out to Trey in the Bay on a boomerang. What up?
What up? I'm just now getting on. I didn't even hear none of the interviews or none of the shows this morning. But hey, they talk about AJ and Poulet fighting. I'm Fury. What is going on with the Fury AJ stuff? Because Fury still got to fight Wilder.
That's exactly the point. And that's why this week when we gave you the information from, you know, Frank Warren and Top Rank and MTK, and they made it specific that any information leading a fight concerning Tyson should only be taken seriously coming from them. But we still are reporting that Eddie is saying to Adam Smith from Sky Sports that if the Poulet fight goes past the summer, they will absolutely look into doing the unification with Joshua and Fury.
Oh, okay, yeah. Also, so they're going to make him... Yeah, they're gonna use the unification, the undisputed, the Trent demanded to me.
Yeah.
That's cool. I'd rather see that than Pulev's ass anyway, right?
Yeah, but both fights, I think, are being pushed back. Like, we know the Wilder fight is going to get pushed back because it was never announced for July 18th. That was just the date everyone was using, but they didn't have an official announcement.
Yeah.
And you got
to. So
promote.
He still had to fight Poulet. Eddie just running his mouth then.
Oh yeah, but he's giving us something to talk about. Truth be told, I mean, imagine if we didn't have guys like Eddie, what would we be doing right now? Other than interviewing.
We
still get the interview though. All
right, that's my call.
All right. Rap and Combat. I don't think I went to you. What's up, brother? Good morning.
What up, though? How are you?
All good. Can't complain, man.
Yeah, man. So I've been tuned in. I took some notes and stuff from what people have been calling in and sharing and stuff. And I think you definitely got something with the fight watch and just watching some recaps. You know, March Madness was a thing. You could have some fun with it, do bracket style. You know, like go with different weight classes or something like that, maybe heavyweights. Start off with maybe welterweight, so it gives you more time because we're going to have a few days without boxing anyway. So this could be cool. And, you know, like bring some interactivity with it as well, too. I think if you get some of these listeners and stuff like that to either hit you up on IG and take a picture or something with their list, or maybe even on Twitter so you get more engagement on those sides, it could be great avenues to, like, work with. You know, so... you know, I think I told you about the hot mic thing, too, to do commentary for fight watches and stuff like that. That's also a good one. And, you know, like I know you saw the YouTube comments. Let's definitely get some more music talk going on, too, especially that rap. I think it'll get a lot of people just calling in and sharing what they want to share about that, too, man. But other than that, man, yo, shout out to Stainless because that song is fire. Real quick, shout out to this dude on Twitter. I think he just started following you or he just started shouting you on Twitter. Well, his name is at the Fans Corner. Just want to quickly shout him out because he's been showing love. And yeah, make sure you guys check the Twitter too, because there's a lot of room to grow there. But that's really it. All right. One love.
For sure. Listen, man, we definitely need some volunteers to handle some of these social medias. Just a lot to be on every avenue. I am replying at the drop of a dime to everybody on Patreon and obviously my Instagram. Those are the quickest, most, you know, efficient ways to get to me or have a question answered, whether that be me walking you through anything about Patreon, the next show, where's the show, all that. Speaking of the show, let's get a quick... Yes, sir. We gained another one. We had 317. So 500. Here we
go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
That's right. I'm ready. That's right. We almost there, man. We're going to have to do a live-a-thon or something. Maybe we go live on a... Damn, there's no fight. Oh. Imagine it would have been a nice Saturday fight. We go live, you know, just stay live. Let's say Saturday from, I don't know, some live-a-thon. We got to figure it out. I don't want to do like Canelo and say 152 and I'm stuck at it. You know what I'm saying? No way. Intrigue, you want that boomerang or what? No, just listening. All right. That means basically we are done and done for the count. Caesar, you never press one, but you know that because I said that. And yeah. All right. So next GTO, Instagram and Twitter.
At Marmugia, Twitter, at Marmugia, Instagram.
Peace. Really quick, actually, really quick. So I scheduled. Yeah, you know, and this is what I'm telling you, man. Patreon has stepped it up. I've never scheduled the Untitled post, so it is scheduled to come out at Saturday midnight, technically Sunday midnight, 12 a.m. Eastern, so that, you know, UK people and everybody can have a full 24 hours before Monday at 7 p.m. when we go live with Untitled. So you have technically more than 24 hours to put in your topic for Untitled. So it will always come out Sunday at Saturday midnight, you know, Sunday technically 12:01. Yeah, just wanted to say that because, again, you're going to find the best experience on Patreon, because moving forward, we're not chasing views, we're chasing you. Damn, that sounds good. Voice of the people, peace.
Peace.